You know, AEW, in the month of March, had a lot of really good television shows. Talked about that here. Not just the big business show. There was a period of about 5 or 6 weeks where the show was just very well-booked. A lot of great matches. They were moving stories forward. And I thought Dynamite, in some ways, had recaptured the magic that had been missing for a while, which is not to say that Dynamite has been a terrible show for all this time, but it was definitely missing a lot of the magic that it used to have. And then we come into the month of April. I was hoping that momentum would carry over into Dynasty. CM Punk goes on Ariel Helwani's show last week, and the world ends because Ariel, of course, asks him about AEW, which he is well within his rights to do. And look, if I had gotten a sit-down interview with CM Punk, there were a lot of questions relative to AEW that I would want to ask, too. So I don't blame Ariel for doing it. And Punk didn't have to answer it, but you know what? To his credit, he did answer the questions. He didn't pull a Tony Khan and say, I appreciate you asking that question, but I really can't talk about it. He said more in that interview than I thought he would be able to, legally. There's just a lot that I thought he wouldn't be able to talk about. He couldn't talk about Brawl Out because of NDAs and things of that nature. But he was very open about Brawl In and what happened at Wembley Stadium last year with him and Jack Perry. And he answered a whole bunch of questions about it. I talked about it on the podcast, and I made my thoughts on that very well known. Not to beat a dead horse here and relitigate the entire thing all over again, there are no innocent parties involved in any of that nonsense. And I'm not going to get into the whole thing again because you've already heard it. Right, we could take it all the way back 2 years to the beginning of 2022, and you can pick out all the people who bear some responsibility for all the shit that happened as it rolled down the hill, heading into Chicago at All Out, and then heading into Wembley Stadium at All In last year. Right, Tony Khan, CM Punk, The Bucks, Hangman, no completely innocent parties in all of this. But CM Punk talked about what led to the events of Brawl In with him and Jack Perry, and Jack Perry making the comment into the camera, you know, real glass, cry me a river. And so he confronted Jack and he asked him, why do you do that internet bullshit? And Jack supposedly made comments back to him. And then CM Punk, with the mother of all comments, which was defended by so many people who, of course, are CM Punk fans, so they will defend this man to the death, says, well, you know, I thought I was doing the responsible thing. I didn't punch him. I just choked him a little bit, and he said it with a smirk on his face. And I'm sure in the moment, CM Punk enjoyed putting his hands on Jack Perry. But the fact is, when you assault your coworker, especially more than once, he has a history of doing this, you need to go. Tony Khan made a very difficult decision. He got rid of the biggest draw that he had in the entire company. Bryan Danielson talked about this because he outsourced the decision to Bryan Danielson, who was on the disciplinary committee. And Bryan Danielson was one of, I believe, three people. He and some lawyers who ultimately made the decision that CM Punk had to be fired. And he considered Punk a friend. He said it was a very difficult thing to do, but even they came to the conclusion. This man was fired with cause. He had to go. And then CM Punk went back to WWE, 10 years away, the triumphant return, people losing their minds, social media records being set, merchandise flying off the shelves. I'm back home, you know, like this incredible turn of events where CM Punk went back to where he used to be. He went back home. And you think that that's the end of it, right? AEW's got to move on. CM Punk's got to move on. Life goes on. And yet, Tony Khan makes the announcement on Collision the other night that on Dynamite this week, he is going to air footage. Now, I never mentioned CM Punk by name, but it was very clear what they were doing here. Makes the announcement that they're going to air footage from All In, backstage at Wembley Stadium, an event that happened 7 months ago and is one of the black eyes, one of the big black eyes on this company in AEW history, regardless of who you believe is at fault. The fact that there is a Brawl Out and a Brawl In, hopefully there's never a Brawl In between and they don't release some sort of three-disc DVD set, right? Most companies will not have a Brawl Out, let alone a Brawl In. That is nothing to tout. That is nothing to be proud of. It is a dark cloud over this company that a lot of people wish was never there in the first place. But now we're going to dredge it all up again. Because CM Punk went on Ariel Helwani's show because he's got a show on YouTube. And he said all these things uncontested. And now Tony Khan feels like, well, the gloves are off. And so we're going to air some footage on Dynamite this week. And I had a lot of people who said, you know, let it play out. I can't tell you how many times I heard that over the years when it came to WWE storylines, right? Which ended up being shit in the end. But you would hear it so many times, let it play out. Let's see. Maybe it'll have something to do with a storyline for the Young Bucks. Maybe it'll have something to do with a storyline to bring Jack Perry back to AEW, which, of course, even if it does, who gives a fuck? But whatever the case may be, let it play out. Let's see what they actually are. Maybe it'll be a swerve, right? And Tony Khan said, no. We don't do that here in AEW. We deliver on our promises. Well, I let it play out. And I watched the footage. And I'm not impressed. And all it did was reinforce my thoughts going into this in the first place, that this was a colossal mistake and a huge embarrassment for this company. Do you realize that AEW has a pay-per-view, a brand new pay-per-view? This is the first Dynasty coming up in less than 2 weeks, right? Big double main event. Samoa Joe defends the AEW World Championship against Swerve Strickland. You've got Bryan Danielson and Will Ospreay for the very first time, a match that a lot of people thought they would never see. And we're going to have the chance to see it for the first time. Right? That's coming up in less than 2 weeks. Do you know what people are going to be talking about coming out of this show tonight? And I'm not just talking about people like me. I'm not just talking about podcasters and reporters and people like that. Do you know what people are going to be talking about coming out of this show tonight? They are going to be talking about CM Punk, a man who has not worked for this company in 7 months. But he was at WrestleMania this past weekend. There he was, in fact, at the very end of WrestleMania, celebrating with Cody Rhodes. We're talking about CM Punk and Brawl In. And the other thing that people are going to be talking about that happened on the show tonight is Will Ospreay taking a shot at Paul Levesque. Yes, Will Ospreay went out there in his promo tonight and took a little dig back at Triple H. Because Triple H made a comment about him where? On the Pat McAfee show. Boy, all these shows, Ariel Helwani show, Pat McAfee show, they're making headlines here. At least the Pat McAfee show, I guess they simulcast that shit on TV. Those are the two things. And more so, the first thing. But those are the two things that people are going to be talking about coming out of this television show tonight. That does AEW nothing. That does this company absolutely no favors. How does this benefit? I'm going to use words that Cash Wheeler himself said. When FTR came out at the end of the segment after the Bucks showed that footage and we had FTR unannounced come down to the ring, right? They stormed down to the ring. And the first words out of Cash Wheeler's mouth are, what does that accomplish? What is the point of that? What is the point of airing that footage? Now, he said that in a storyline sense. I ask you that question in a real-world sense, in a practical real-world sense, what the fuck does that do for AEW? Are you telling me that that puts more heat on the Young Bucks FTR match going into Dynasty? Because I don't give a shit. I mean, we've seen the Young Bucks and FTR wrestle at least 3 times already anyway. Now we're going to get it again, and I'm sure they're going to have a very good match at the pay-per-view. But now, this is all people are going to be talking about. How does this put heat on the Young Bucks? All it does is make them and Tony Khan and the entire company seem petty as fuck. How does that benefit AEW? What exactly was Tony Khan hoping to accomplish by airing this footage? Because I watched the footage, and I know all of you did, and if you didn't, we're going to talk about it. It's very brief. It's very uneventful. If you were watching this footage expecting to see a knockdown, drag-out brawl, boy, were you disappointed. I've seen better fights than this on the fucking bus going home. There really wasn't much to it. And it pretty much backed up largely everything CM Punk had to say, although he did make mention about how I didn't throw a punch, I just choked the guy a little bit. And it looked like at the very end there, just before Samoa Joe pulled away Jack Perry, that Punk did get a punch in, or maybe he missed, but he threw something. Outside of that, it played out pretty much the way CM Punk indicated that it did. So if the goal was to make CM Punk out to be a liar or to embarrass him in some way, depending on where you fall on this whole CM Punk thing to begin with, whether or not you thought he was in the right or not, he wasn't, but whether or not you think he was or not, CM Punk is not any more or less embarrassed today than he was in August of 2023 when this all went down. Because if you believe that CM Punk was justified in his actions, then there is absolutely nothing that you saw in this video tonight that's going to change your mind. And if you thought CM Punk was being a bully, if you thought CM Punk was being immature, if you think he did the wrong thing by putting his hands on a coworker, all this did was reinforce that point. This footage did nothing to change the narrative. People have already made up their minds. And I'm looking ahead now, and again, I'm looking at a pay-per-view, and I'm saying, how the fuck does this benefit this company? How does this put more heat on the Bucks in a way that's going to make AEW money? That's going to get more people to buy this pay-per-view? Zero. Zero is the number of people who are going to buy this pay-per-view who were not going to buy it before. So I did wait, and I did let it play out, and I watched it. And yes, they tried to weave it into the storyline by having FTR come out and cut this impassioned promo, and they're very good at that. And they come out and they talk about the match coming up with the Bucks. The Bucks try to portray it as, well, the only reason we lost to FTR at Wembley in that last match is because we were distracted by what was going on behind the scenes. What's very clear to me, it was very transparent from the beginning what they were doing here, but boy, I mean, it was like Stretch Armstrong trying to come up with a rationale for why this footage should air. The footage aired because Dynamite has been in the dumps ratings-wise now for several weeks. Tony Khan has brought in a lot of talent into this company. He has brought in Okada. He has brought in Ospreay. He has brought in Mercedes, who we found out is not wrestling until the end of May. Great. But he's signing all these free agents. They cut 10 people from the roster last week, one of whom is already coming back because Tony Khan admitted, I made a mistake. You know, upon further reflection, I really shouldn't have fired this guy, Anthony Henry, who got his fucking jaw broken a few weeks ago at an independent show and is sitting at home convalescing, so I've changed my mind. When he's healed up, I'll bring him back. But the other 9 people, well, they're shit out of luck. But he does that at a time when he's giving interviews openly talking about how, oh, I have to cut budget here because I've spent too much money coming into this year already, and I want to sign more free agents. I'm not stopping now. We got Okada and Ospreay Mercedes, oh my, Okada and Ospreay Mercedes, oh my, but I want to sign more free agents. We're going to bring more people into the company. So far, it hasn't really done them a lot of good. The ratings have gone backwards. They have not gone forwards. And so what does Tony Khan do? He falls back on his old tried and true. He falls back on CM Punk. He is relying on a man that he fired who has not worked for his company in 7 months to draw a rating. I would expect Dynamite tonight to do a pretty good number. I can't even predict what it's going to be. I'm sure it'll be higher than what it's been. So what? Let's say they do 850,000 people tonight, which is a struggle for them to even hit that lately. Let's say they do 900,000 people tonight, because I'm not even sure they'll do 1 million, even with all this hype. So what? You think they're going to do that next week? Maybe if they promote the fact that we've got some exclusive, never-before-seen footage of CM Punk when he used to work here, maybe that would work. No, they did this because they want, first of all, they were gotten to by his comments. They allowed it to get under their skin, which to a degree is understandable if they feel like he's lying. But again, you watch that footage, and I didn't see a whole lot that was different than the version he said to Ariel Helwani. But it's very clear they did this because they wanted to pop a rating. And they decided, well, we'll wrap it around this existing storyline so that way we can justify it. No. No. It was a reach at best. They wanted an excuse to put CM Punk back on their show. They got their wish tonight. And look, I hope they get a good number out of it. But I think this did way more damage than anything else. And there are going to be a lot of people who look very differently upon AEW now than they did 24 hours ago. I don't understand the rationale behind this. Because if this man goes out there and says something that you don't like in an interview, off television, a man, again, who does not work for you anymore, there are other ways that you can respond to this man. You can respond on social media. You can respond on your website. You can respond in any number of ways. Put the footage up if you want to. But it's kind of like Adam Copeland coming out on Dynamite last week and spending the first 8 minutes of the show talking about how great AEW is. This is the second week in a row now that Tony Khan is wasting television time. Will Ospreay comes out there tonight and says, Tony told me I have 5 minutes because TV time is expensive. Yeah, no shit. So why is Copeland coming out last week and spending 8 minutes giving a rah-rah speech about how great AEW is? Didn't tie into anything. Didn't tie into any stories. That was last week. This week we had the Young Bucks segment. However long that was. I mean, the actual footage was maybe a minute and 10 seconds, but the segment, the FTR segment that followed, all this television time that they are wasting, this expensive television time that Tony Khan says is very valuable. They sure are spending a lot of that television time on something that really has no business being on television, unless you are desperate to pop a number, because the numbers lately have been very soft. I don't understand it. I really don't. I don't see how this benefits them in any meaningful way. All it does is make them look petty and stupid. CM Punk did himself no favors by doing what he did in the first place. He claims he quit. They say they fired him. Whichever version that you believe, you can't put your hands on your coworker like that. I mean, there was one aspect to what CM Punk said in the interview with Ariel when it came to why he put his hands on Jungle Boy that didn't match up. I'm going to wait until we get to that part here to get into the details. Nobody comes out of this looking good. Except one person, maybe. And that is Samoa Joe. Because one thing that was very clear from the footage that they aired tonight, and Punk backed this up in what he said, and even the reports at the time pretty much backed up the fact that Samoa Joe was one of the only adults in the room. You know why? Because Samoa Joe is a veteran. Samoa Joe is a man. Samoa Joe is an adult. That's what we need more of in this company. More adults in the room. Tony Khan is sitting there. You don't actually see his face. You see his hand reaching over the monitors there. He never actually stands up and tries to assist in the situation because apparently he's scared shitless. Thank God Samoa Joe is there to step in and break things up because he's an adult. And that's what you do in a situation like that. You don't go choking people because you feel like it. You don't go choking people because, oh, he's a little mouthy to me. So I'll show him in front of my boss and in front of everybody else here. 2 minutes before I'm supposed to walk out to have this world championship match at the beginning of this pay-per-view in front of 75,000 people. I don't want to hear people justifying CM Punk's actions either, because he comes out of this looking as bad as anybody else. Nothing has changed. Nothing I said then is any different than what I am saying now. And the fact that it took 7 months to see this footage, and this is the footage? This is what we're talking about here. And yes, this you watch this and you think this is what got CM Punk fired. But again, let's not lose sight of the fact that he still put his hands on his coworker. I just love how some people still gloss over that fact. Nobody comes out of this looking good. When this show was over, I wasn't talking about Samoa Joe and Swerve at the end of the show and the angle they did. And I wasn't talking about the great match that I thought Adam Copeland and Penta had earlier in the show. All people are going to be talking about is exactly what I am talking about right now, and that is the problem. This company is completely fucking lost. And it doesn't reflect well on the leadership of that company that they thought this was going to be a good decision. That they thought when this was done airing, people would be like, I get it now. Now it all makes sense. Tony, of course. I would do the same thing. Now I know why he aired this footage. Yes, now I do. And it's fucking sad. It's embarrassing. It really is. I don't know. I don't know what they're thinking. I don't know where this company is going. But if their goal tonight was to embarrass the other party, all they did was embarrass themselves. This is your AEW Dynamite review. It is April 10th, 2024. I am the Solomonster. We're going to talk about that segment. We're going to talk about that and a lot of other things here. Do me a favor. I want to say thank you first and foremost because we hit 79,000 subscribers late last night. So thank you to the 79K. Now we begin the march to 80. But I can only do that with your help. So make sure you hit that subscribe button. 450 likes was the goal for Be the Booker. I don't know where the fuck we are now, but I'm sure that's not going to be a problem tonight. So hit that like button as well. Super chats are open too. You'll see them popping up on your screen. Let's start from the beginning here before we even get into the Young Bucks shit. And they don't look much better in this than Tony Khan or anybody else. So sick of all these fucking people. To be honest with you, I really am. I mean, I really am. And I'm not going to sit here and lie to you and say that every time I talk about this Punk stuff and the Elite and Tony Khan, oh, it does great. Yeah, of course it does. Of course, we got 4,000 fucking people sitting in here tonight. You think we'd have 4,000 people sitting in here for a normal episode of Dynamite? It's controversy. People love controversy, but at some point, it's like, why are we still talking about this shit? It's exhausting. We opened with an AEW World Championship Eliminator match, or at least we were supposed to, with the champion Samoa Joe taking on Dustin Rhodes, a Samoan champion taking on one of Dusty's sons. How original. Never got started, though, because Joe walked out first and was immediately jumped from behind by a crazed Swerve Strickland, who was left bloody at the end of their contract signing last week. So they brawled off the ramp, right to the side over by the stage. Joe grabbed a table. It was sitting right there. It had a black tarp over it.
Samoa bro.
Tablecloth. He pulled the tablecloth off. He propped the table up against the barricade, the guardrail. But he ended up getting speared through the table by Swerve when he turned around. And so both men were down. Swerve made it back to his feet. He got escorted off by officials. And the other people tended to Joe, and they helped him to the back. So we did not, in fact, get this as the opener here. But it would end up happening later on in the show in the main event. Excalibur said they had a pivot. So they aired footage of Trent Beretta turning on Orange Cassidy last week on the show. Chris Statlander confronted Beretta backstage. He whispered something to her before walking off. Back live, Renee was standing outside Orange Cassidy's locker room and said that she was told that Cassidy was going to have a match on Rampage this Friday, and he would explain how he felt about Trent Beretta's actions at that point. So instead, the opening match was a TNT Championship match. It was Adam Copeland defending against Penta El Cerro Miedo. One of the moments of great light on tonight's show, this was honestly the best part of the entire show, was the opening match that we got here between Copeland and Penta. I actually enjoyed this match quite a bit. Unfortunately, I wish there was more like this to talk about on the show tonight, but there really isn't. So they also announced that Copeland, Eddie Kingston, and Mark Briscoe, the new Ring of Honor World Champion, are going to be teaming up. They're going to be in a trios match at Dynasty against the House of Black. And let me take a moment here also to just talk about this, because Mark Briscoe is the brand new Ring of Honor World Heavyweight Champion. Now, the Ring of Honor World title is what you make of it. Do I think the Ring of Honor World title has the same prestige and value that it once did once upon a time? No, it doesn't. But it was a cool moment for him and for his family at Supercard of Honor. He won the title 11 years to the day that his late brother, Jay Briscoe, won the ROH title for the very first time. Hey, Ken, thank you. And so that was a very cool moment to see all the kids in the ring and the family celebrating. So I'm glad he had that moment. Whatever you think or I think of the Ring of Honor World title itself right now, that was a very cool moment. I was happy to see him get that. But here, Penta caught Copeland early with a spear. Almost right from the beginning, he speared him, hit his own move on him, went for the pin. Copeland kicked out. Penta was in control after a break, and Copeland started going move for move with him. Tilt-a-whirls. Copeland was doing he was doing front face leapfrog. Then he would jump up and do a backwards leapfrog. We ended up with a double down after they both had the same idea and they booted each other in the face. So both men were down. You know, I saw Copeland doing all these leapfrogs, and it made me think of all those years ago. He was in a house show match with Jeff Hardy, and it was very simple. He was doing a leapfrog to avoid him, and that's when he blew out his Achilles. That was right after he and Jericho won the tag titles, and so they were just about to start their run together, and on a simple leapfrog, he blew out his Achilles. That's when we ended up getting Jericho instead. But he didn't have any such issues here doing all these leapfrogs. They also, at this point, showed a countdown clock. So they were really milking this Young Bucks thing. They had a countdown clock in the corner of the screen with a picture of the Young Bucks there that showed 19 minutes until they aired the footage from All In. So again, if you don't think that this was not a rating stunt and not much more than that, other than the fact that, again, Tony Khan was highly bothered and upset by the comments that CM Punk made, if you think it was anything other than a ratings ploy, then you're not paying attention. They got the countdown clock. Remember WWE for a while had the Cody clock in the corner so we knew when Cody Rhodes was going to come out? That's what they had in the corner of the screen. So it was T-minus 19 minutes until showtime. Copeland ended up on the floor after a sling blade, and then he got taken out by a flying swanton. That took us into the second picture-in-picture break of this match. After the break, Copeland caught Penta on his shoulders. He dropped him down face first. And then he locked in what he calls, or used to call, the education, which is a kneeling inverted sharpshooter. Penta was able to escape. Then Copeland got him locked in a crossface, but Penta got his foot on the bottom rope for a break. So Copeland ended up on the apron. Penta went for a springboard move to the apron. He got booted on his way down. So now Copeland is on the apron, and now he's got Penta on his shoulders. Penta fights out, and now he sets up Copeland for his package pile driver. He sets him up for the Fear Factor on the apron. Copeland fights out, and he backs Penta up to the post. And so now Penta gets a running start, and he charges towards Copeland. Copeland catches him, and they're on the apron, and gives him a power slam on the apron. So that was cool. I don't remember the last time I saw a running power slam on the apron like that. That was a cool spot. Now on the floor, Copeland wrecked Alex Abrahantes with a spear when Penta moved out of the way. Down goes Alex. Who will sell those HP laptops now on QVC if Alex is hurt? That's what I want to know. Back inside, Penta catches Copeland with an avalanche code red off the ropes for a near fall. Penta hit the arm breaker, bends the arm back. Cope kicked out. Here comes the Fear Factor. Copeland fights out of it. Penta springboards off the ropes. And as he is flying off the ropes, Copeland spears him out of midair and pins him to retain the TNT Championship. A very good 20-minute battle. And those are the kinds of matches, the kinds of fresh opponents that I like seeing with Copeland. I like seeing him in the ring with someone like Penta, who I've never seen him wrestle before. I mean, the stuff with him and Christian was great, but it's when we get matches like this, and he goes out there, I mean, it was like he was trying to turn back the hands of time with some of the moves he was doing. He was trying to keep up with him, and they ended up having a very good match. Now, after the match, the lights went out, and when they came back on, Julia Hart was in the ring, staring down Copeland. Brody King attacks Copeland from behind, puts him in a rear naked choke. Julia was about to do something, but here comes Willow Nightingale, her opponent in Dynasty. She comes down to the ring, tackles Julia down. Brody pulls Julia to the corner, and then we get a face-to-face here between Julia Hart and Brody King. Now, Julia must have spit the mist or a little bit of the mist because Willow had mist, some black mist. Not a lot of it, but she had mist on her face that wasn't there when she ran out. And she wasn't selling it like she was burned or anything like that, so that looked a little weird. Copeland recovered, low-bridged King, out goes Brody. Willow Nightingale making the save for Adam Copeland is not what I was expecting here, but I like the way they weaved her story with Julia into things because they are wrestling at Dynasty for the TBS title. This is a very good match. This was the highlight of the night. It was only downhill after this. Renee was backstage, case in point, backstage with Chris Jericho. Hook was there as well as Katsuyori Shibata, and they bring up their trios match tonight. Renee asks Hook something, Jericho cuts her off, he's going to answer instead. And Jericho said that they're all going to sit under the learning tree of Jericho. And if they listen to him and they breathe the rarefied air of Jericho, the last thing I want to be breathing in, there's nothing but success for them for the future. So Jericho left. Shibata, his gimmick is that he's got a translator app. So he doesn't speak English, or at least not very well. So he's got a translator app on his phone, and so you hear the robotic voice ask, what's his deal? And Hook says, eh, don't worry about it. So Hook walks off. Now it's just Shibata and Renee. And using the app, he compliments her on her necklace that she was wearing, and that was the end of this segment. Renee was backstage after a break with Mark Briscoe and Eddie Kingston congratulating Mark on winning the ROH title from Eddie this past weekend. Both men were all amped up for their trios match coming up at Dynasty. Adam Copeland walks into the shot along with Willow Nightingale and Stokely Hathaway, and Copeland was sucking wind as he was speaking. He was trying to breathe. As he's cutting this promo, he says, we're all good for Dynasty. And then Stokely tells Copeland, hey, why don't you put the TNT title on the line against Willow? Willow thinks this is a ridiculous idea. but she has another idea of her own. And Willow proposes a mixed tag team match where she teams with Adam Copeland to take on Brody King and Julia Hart. And he likes that idea a lot more. Hathaway also tried to apologize to Eddie Kingston for saying that he smelled like Burger King in Newports the last time they saw each other. And Eddie rolled his eyes and walked away. And then it was time. Doc Brown, get the DeLorean ready. It's time to go back in time to August of 2023. Feels like a lifetime ago. We go to the back, a pre-tape segment, obviously, with the Young Bucks, Matthew and Nicholas Jackson. And they explain that, you know, we got a big match coming up with FTR and Dynasty. The last time we wrestled them was Wembley Stadium at All In. And they said that they still had some wounds that had not healed yet. A lot of critics said that whoever wins that match would be considered the greatest tag team of a generation. Matthew said before their match, an incident occurred with the scapegoat. The lovable kid, Jack Perry, who reminded them a lot of him at his age, which probably says a lot. The other individual tried to make it all about himself. It also happens to be someone who was very good friends with FTR. Nicholas wondered if maybe FTR were the masterminds behind the entire situation. So again, this was their way of trying to... They needed an excuse to air this footage because they could have aired it a week after it happened. They didn't do that. And so now it's like, well, we have to come up with a reason to air this, but we really want to air it because we really want to show the people. I don't know. Again, I'm at a loss for what they were hoping to show here, but this was their way of weaving it into the Young Bucks and FTR storyline. Again, it's a reach, but this was their way of doing it. So they're wondering if maybe FTR were the masterminds behind the entire thing. So there was a jump cut here. Matthew said that they were thrown off their game as a result of what happened in the back. He said they had put their EVP caps on. He said the locker room was in disarray and there were respectable wrestling journalists who needed answers. So Matthew said that they had no time to hydrate. They didn't even have time to pray. He said the history books show that FTR beat them in London, but he feels that there should be a giant asterisk next to it. Matthew said the footage was short, and it resembled less of a fight or a brawl and more of a high school scrap. He said the ramifications of the incident threatened to take down their biggest show of all time. And then they showed the footage. Now what you see here is just a screen grab. So it's grainy footage. This is security camera footage that they aired from backstage at Wembley Stadium. And there you see, in the Triple X jacket there is CM Punk with his back turned. He's talking to Jungle Jack. To the left in the corner, there's Samoa Joe. He's getting ready because he and Punk were opening the show in their match. So he's getting ready to go out. You can't see him. He's being blocked by a light. You see the shorts, though. Hook, who had just wrestled Jack Perry, is standing basically right next to them. And again, this footage went on for maybe a minute and 10 seconds at the most. So there's no audio to any of this. Jack Perry had just come back from his match with Hook. And Samoa Joe is standing there. Now, Hook, forget Hook for a second. We'll get back to Hook. Punk walks up to him. Okay, this is a few seconds into the footage. Punk walks up to Jack Perry. We see the two talking. Or more likely, it was CM Punk who was doing the talking. Punk then gives Jack Perry a hard shove. And he puts him in a front face lock for what I counted was about 6 seconds. Wasn't any more than that. Samoa Joe is right there, so he sees this, and he immediately rushes over to break them up. Referee Paul Turner, who you also see there, he rushes in. Jerry Lynn rushes over to break them up. And it did look like Punk threw a punch at Perry's head right before Joe pulled Jack Perry away. I don't know that it connected. It could have been just a wild swing. It was impossible to see if the punch connected from the angle they showed us here. Now, Hook is standing around. Like, he doesn't know what's going on. The fact that they would even air this with Perry and Hook, who had a feud going on for months and had just wrestled a match, that they're just standing next to each other, that's embarrassing enough. So we don't get a great view of Tony Khan. You're not going to see Tony Khan here in this footage. But he's there. He's to the right, Behind that All In banner, there's a table. That's basically where the gorilla position is. That's where he's on headset. The one thing you can see in the video is Tony Khan. He's kind of putting his hand out because these guys, they brush up against the table. So remember, when the reports initially came out, there were reports about monitors being knocked over and stuff. That was it, right there. They kind of bumped into the desk. The monitors were just knocked a little bit. You know, nothing significant, but that was the whole monitors were knocked over thing. And Tony Khan, he doesn't do much of anything. He certainly didn't get up to go over and make any attempt to calm things down. He left that to Joe and Paul Turner and Jerry Lynn. Now, after they pull them apart, Punk is obviously incensed. He does lunge in Tony's direction, and he has to be held back. Now, there's no audio, so we can't see anything that's being done. We can't hear anything that's being said. That must have been the part where Punk claims he told Tony, you know, you're a clown, I quit. Malachi Black is there. Chris Hero gets up from around the desk. He was sitting next to Tony. Chris Hero gets up. He comes from around the table where Tony is to try to calm things down because, again, Chris Hero's looking at this going, what the hell's going on here? I slapped this together just before I went on the air because this is the first thing I thought of in the shot of Chris Hero putting his hands up on his face. He looks like the fucking guy from the painting The Scream. Look at this. This right here, they should put this whole video, they should put this in a fucking museum somewhere. This is Chris Hero putting his hands on his face because he can't believe what the fuck is going on here. Neither can I. This is the first thing I thought of. I said, I have to do this. This is ridiculous. I mean, this entire thing is ridiculous. And that was it. That was the footage. Now they come back to the Bucks. And the Bucks say, well, that wasn't even the worst part of the incident. And Matthew says the worst part was creating a wrestling show and naming a wrestling show and filling the building with the most people who have ever witnessed a wrestling show ever in history, only to be distracted by something so stupid that you lose on your big night. And then he says that FTR, they had the balls to shake their hands, which we're not going to do at Dynasty. And Nicholas storms off. And then we see that Matthew is wearing a scapegoat shirt. Amazing. That was the entire thing. And when it was over, as I said at the beginning, I sat here and I thought to myself, what did this accomplish? The footage was nothing to be excited about. What are we doing here that we are seeing this on this television show here 7 months later, right? It was pretty much everything that we already knew. It was pretty much everything CM Punk had said that it was. But again, I want to point out Samoa Joe to you because Samoa Joe, he jumped into action right away. It's a good thing that he was there. Or else, who knows? Jack Perry may have gone out. He rushed over. He was instrumental in breaking that thing up as quickly as possible because that's what a locker room leader does. That's what a locker room leader does. That's what Samoa Joe is. Samoa Joe is not going to tolerate this shit. What were all the reports at the time? Samoa Joe was angry. Remember little DJ Wu Kid? Is that who it was? They had DJ Wu Kid who was backstage that night. He was on some podcast or radio show and he described everything that happened. He goes, I couldn't believe what I was seeing. And he said this big Hawaiian dude was like going off on everybody. Yeah, Samoa Joe was the big Hawaiian dude. Let's just go with it. He backed it up too and said that Joe was incensed and he was going crazy because he's looking at this going, what the fuck are you guys doing? He's about to walk out there for the biggest match of his life. Samoa Joe is opening the show at CM Punk in front of 75,000 people, and now it's in jeopardy because of this nonsense. So of course he was upset. And he's telling everybody, shut the fuck up and get the fuck out there. And Punk said, Ariel Helwani asked him, why did you do it? Why'd you go out there if you quit? Why'd you go out and do the match? And Punk said, because out of respect to Joe. Out of respect to Joe, to Paul Turner, the referee, and to Jerry Lynn. I went out there and did my job. That and all these people who came to see me, probably came to see me, so I went out there to wrestle Samoa Joe. But credit to Samoa Joe, because that's what a veteran does. You know what a veteran does not do? You know what someone who knows better and is supposed to be a leader in this company? I mean, he was the face of Collision. Tony Khan thought enough of him that he only got Collision because of Punk. He basically gave the show to CM Punk. You know what a leader does? A leader leads by example. It's not do as I say, not as I do. It's do as I do. He doesn't go around putting his hands on people because they got mouthy with him. Or because they said something that pissed him off that he didn't like. Aw. CM Punk made a career out of saying things to people that they didn't like. I bet if he would have mouthed off to the wrong person in that WWE locker room back then with all those guys, Undertaker and Batista and people like that, they would have had him on the ground in a front face lock. And that wouldn't have made it any right than this was. But the fact is, you cannot ignore the fact, when you watch the footage, Jack Perry at no point got aggressive. Now, we don't know what he said. Doesn't matter what he said. It doesn't even matter what he said. We don't even need to hear the audio. You watch the footage. What was the comment that Punk made in the interview with Ariel right before he described choking out Jack Perry? He said, oh, it's something that Chael Sonnen told him. Don't let them get close. Right? Don't let them get close. As if he were threatened by Jack Perry. One thing that is very clear from watching this footage is that there was no threat. There was no threat. There was no physical threat by Jack Perry. He said something that CM Punk didn't like, and CM Punk gave him a hard shove. Even if he said do something about it. Gave him a hard shove, and then put him in a front face lock. And continued to, you know, his outburst here, like a fucking toddler. That's what CM Punk did. There is nothing in this video that makes me think, oh, you know what? Punk was in the right. You know what? Punk had every right to do what he did. No, he didn't. That has not changed. So you can admit that Tony Khan has fault here. This person has fault. That person has fault. You cannot say that CM Punk does not have fault and that AEW did not have cause to fire him. That is why they got rid of him. I would have done the exact same thing. Even if it was at the expense of business, which clearly it was. He was their biggest draw. The fact that they got rid of him spoke volumes. So that much was clear from watching the footage. He was the one who got physical, not Jack Perry. There was no threat. There was no, you know, imminent threat to him or his safety or anything like that. Punk has to be the adult in that situation. And you know what? If you have an issue with Jack Perry and this kid's getting mouthy with you, this fucking brat, who does he think he is talking to me? You know what? Be the bigger man. Go out there, have your match, because you're opening the show, right? Go out there and have your match with Samoa Joe and then deal with it after. The fuck are you doing this right before you're walking out there for your fucking match with Samoa Joe? You're going to have a match in the back with this punk kid? He's a hothead. We've already demonstrated this. This is a pattern with him over the course of his entire career. I mean, it goes all the way back. I mean, my God, I can remember when he was out of WWE and The Miz, I think, filled in for him once on one of those WWE backstage shows, and he made a very innocuous comment. It was like a little dig that he took at CM Punk, right? It was nothing overly horrible. What was CM Punk's response? It was to go on social media and say, oh, why don't you go suck a blood-covered dick in Saudi Arabia, you fucking moron, or something like that, right? Like, whoa! Not exactly a justified response to whatever it was that Miz said, but this is who he is. You know, he's got a temper, he's a hothead, and in the past, he's made some poor decisions. And there's still people who can't admit that, right? There were a lot of people who made poor decisions here. It's okay to say that CM Punk made some poor decisions himself, even if you feel like he was pushed to the brink, and he was justified to be as angry and as upset as he was, right? You can say that, but there's a reason why he is no longer working for this company. He did it to himself. He is as much to blame as anything, because you can't just go around putting your hands on your coworkers. That's not a fucking place that I want to work. If there were adults in the room here, it's amazing how things could have been different. If there was communication here, right? Communication is key. No communication going all the way back to the beginning of all this. That's why Punk thinks that people, they're talking about him behind his back. Oh, he's trying to get Colt Cabana fired. No, I'm not. You know what? Let me go talk to Tony and figure out what's going on here. Maybe we can squash this and figure this out. And that brings me to Tony Khan. That brings me to the boss of the situation here in this whole thing. There you see Tony Khan on this video doing absolutely nothing. What we know is that Tony Khan went on television to announce that CM Punk was fired. And in that same clip, not really an interview, but in that same clip, here's the microphone, right? Let's pretend this is the microphone. I've never been more afraid in my entire life. And I've been a wrestling fan and been around wrestling shows for 30 years. And never in my life have I been so scared. Never in my life have I been so worried about my safety. So that was Tony Khan. He was afraid. Good to know. If they had somebody who would have squashed all of this from the very beginning, I think all of this could have been avoided. Even if there were bad feelings on the part of the Elite towards Punk, which I just never understood, because take it back to before CM Punk came into AEW. CM Punk talked about how the members of the Elite would text him, "You got to come in. When are you coming in?" They wanted him in AEW. So did Tony Khan. Tony Khan has said CM Punk was his favorite, and he tried to recruit him into the company from day one. He wanted Punk in the company, right? He was the biggest Punk mark. I mean, when Punk came back, right? When Punk came back to the company, when they brought him back to Collision in June, right? He was sitting allegedly behind the table on his headset in the back going, "CM Punk, CM Punk," right? So no one's a bigger CM Punk fan at the time than Tony Khan. But the Bucks were the ones who were texting him before he came into the company trying to get him to come in. It's not like they didn't want him there. So again, you ask yourself, where did it all go wrong? Is this really all just about Colt Cabana? Somebody who has never been a featured player in this company? Is that really the genesis of all of this? Is Colt fucking Cabana? Had he squashed this at the beginning when he found out that chatter was going on and Punk was bothered by this? Because he apologized to Punk when they were sitting next to each other in Chicago at the scrum, and he said, no, it's my fault. I should have, you know, he said something about an interview that he did and I shouldn't have said that to Forbes, or I don't remember exactly what he said. Forget that. Forget Forbes or Sports Illustrated or any of that shit. He should have taken care of this at the very beginning before we even got to the Hangman promo, before their match at Double or Nothing. Didn't happen. It's old news at this point. But he is as responsible as anyone for this entire mess. And he's the one who made the call to put this footage on the air tonight. So this is on him. This is not on CM Punk. This is not on Jack Perry. This is on Tony Khan. Because if anybody should know better in this situation, it's Tony Khan. Tony Khan needs to focus on his own roster and his own company right now. CM Punk does not work for him. If CM Punk in his mind is slandering him, if CM Punk is saying something that he doesn't believe is true, there are other ways to address it. Don't do it on your television show. This has nothing to do with your promotion for Dynasty. This has nothing to do with any of your free agent signings. Focus on that and putting out the best possible show you can. And don't be so desperate to pop a number because the ratings have taken a slide backwards. Look from within and try to figure out, what are we doing wrong? What can we do? What can I do to try to turn that around and bring those people back and bring some more people in? Let's figure that out first, instead of being consumed by what this man said when he was asked, right? It's not like it was completely unprompted. I mean, he did an interview. Ariel asked him a question. He gave an answer. I don't blame Punk for that. Whatever you think of CM Punk, he was asked a question and he answered it. Tony Khan should have left it alone. He opted not to. This was fucking embarrassing. And you know what I thought was just the perfect encapsulation of the entire thing? When this segment was done airing, they cut back to the announcers at the booth. The look on Tony, I wish I had clipped that. The look on Tony Schiavone's face said it all. When Tony Schiavone was asked about Punk's comments by Conrad on his podcast last week, he didn't really say anything. He's like, yeah, I heard about the Punk thing. He goes, it's all bullshit. I don't want to talk about it, right? I mean, he didn't say it was bullshit. He didn't like dismiss what Punk was saying as false or true or anything. He just is tired of hearing it. He didn't want to talk about it. Jim Ross on his podcast said the same thing. Let's just move forward. Let's move on. Let's look ahead. The look on Tony Schiavone's face when they were done with this, he almost had his head in his hands. He looked so disappointed. Because Tony Schiavone lived through WCW. And you know what this felt like to me as I'm watching this and when it was over? This felt like the dying days of WCW. It felt like something that Russo would do. dredging this up felt like something that you would see on WCW television, where they were throwing shit at the wall because, again, they were struggling. They were up against WWE. They were trying to find stuff that works. They were trying to pop a number. You know, with Russo, it was just all about ratings. What can we do to generate interest and get people to tune into the show? That's what this felt like. And Tony Schiavone lived through it. WCW, he's not working there anymore. You know why he's not working there anymore? Because they're out of fucking business. And he's looking at this going, what the fuck are we doing here? What are we doing here? He knows. He doesn't have to say a word. Just look at the look on his face. Now, FTR, when this segment was over, FTR stormed down to the ring, and Excalibur said, whoa, they're not on the format here. This was not announced. This is not supposed to be happening. Here comes Wheeler. Here comes Harwood. Wheeler is talking about how, what is the point of airing that footage, right? What everybody is probably thinking at this point. He said he's sick and tired of this. Everybody wants to move on. Not everybody, apparently. Instead of showing the talent doing their best work ever, we get footage from 8 months ago, thanks to Rod and Todd Flanders. So again, they're trying to put this on the Bucks to get them heat. They're acknowledging what I just talked about and what everybody is going to be talking about coming out of this segment. But it's okay in their eyes because, well, now it's part of a storyline. So that makes it okay. It's not like we're just desperate or anything like that, which is exactly what they are. And that's exactly how people are going to see it. They're going to see it for what it is. They're not going to see it as some great creative angle that they've come up with here. So good job. Harwood said that the EVPs say without them, AEW wouldn't exist and folks would be without jobs. He said he kind of agrees because without the Bucks, he might still be shaving Wheeler or Harwood's back. What makes the Bucks sick is FTR has eclipsed them as the best team on this planet. At one time, he says the Bucks cared about AEW, but whether it's greed, they lost that. They only care about themselves. Harwood said that on the backs of every single man and woman who want to be here, they will build things on their backs, not just for them, but for the future of pro wrestling. If the Bucks don't want to be part of that, AEW, grab your ball. He said FTR's got this. And then Harwood said, this isn't about Wembley. This isn't about All In. This is about the AEW World Tag Team titles at Dynasty. Two teams walk in. One team walks out. The first three-time tag team champions. Said the Bucks might have built the foundation, but FTR will build the roof and have no issue blowing it off. Top guys out. I appreciate the passion of FTR in this segment. I thought as just a standalone promo, I thought it was very good, but again, none of this should have happened. None of this had any business airing on TV tonight. This was stupid. This was a colossal waste of time. And it was a pathetic attempt to pop a number off of somebody who no longer works there. Do better. This kind of shit is not going to save your show. I don't care if the show does 1.2 million viewers tonight. It'll be the last time they do 1.2 million viewers if this is the kind of shit that they're going to do in the future. Do better, focus on your product, focus on trying to figure out why people are tuning out. You got all the talent in the world. You got fucking Ospreay and Okada alone on your roster now. Figure it out before it's too late. Because more stuff like this is only going to drive people away from the product. That's not what I want to see. I'd like to have two healthy companies. Even if one is healthier than the other, because again, there's no catching up to WWE. I mean, they're a juggernaut. But that doesn't mean you can't have two healthy companies. This, you watch this show tonight, I dare you to tell me that that's the sign of a healthy company. Can't do it. Renee was out on stage. Now, we had another segment that came after this. This is the other thing that some people will be talking about. Renee comes out on stage to interview the aerial assassin, Will Ospreay, one of the new free agent signings. And she said that Ospreay had a few things that he wanted to get off of his chest. And he said that Tony told him he's got 5 minutes. Television time is expensive. Television time is expensive. Yeah. Yeah. Tell me about it. Yeah. I wish Tony Khan would take his own advice. Television time is expensive. How much time do you think it cost them, TV time-wise, to air that segment tonight? Think they're going to make that money back? He said there's this rumor going around that he's afraid of the grind. He has no idea where this is coming from because he's one of the only guys traveling back and forth from the UK to the US, 8 to 10 hours every week, delivering some of the best pro wrestling matches this business has ever seen. And normally he wouldn't even respond to something like this, but seeing as how the man who said it is only in the position he's in because he was grinding on the boss's daughter, you are in no position, he says, to tell him what the grind is all about because you have no idea what I fight for. So let this be a painful little jab back and a reminder that you do not throw stones at an assassin with a machine gun. Now, that was a good line, but you might have people who are watching this who go, what the fuck is he talking about? And the reason they would say, what the fuck is he talking about, is because he's referring to a comment that Paul Levesque made.
Why is Solomonster a punk hater? Does he hate punk so much?
Bring them all out.
What did he ever do to him?
Bring them all out. That's right.
Why do you hate CM Punk?
These are people who can't listen. They got wax between their ears. Thank you, brother. What he's referring to, Triple H was on the Pat McAfee show on Friday, I believe, right before WrestleMania. This is the comment that Paul Levesque made on the Pat McAfee show. When I see people trying to make it and they pick the job where they go, well, I work less and the schedule is lighter. He said, okay, I'm glad I didn't get you. Because if you're not in it for the grind in that point of your career, then you have no business being here. Now, that was a very stupid, tone-deaf comment that Triple H made. That comment right there. I mean, we could talk about how Tony Khan was, like, gotten to by the punk stuff, and that's why we got the footage tonight airing on TV. Triple H sounded gotten to in that interview, that he was very upset that Will Ospreay, and maybe Okada too, but that Will Ospreay, who apparently they had conversations with, they did make a play for him, they wanted him. Ospreay ultimately made the decision that he was going to go to AEW, in part because he still wants to live in the UK. His girlfriend, and I think they have his stepson, I believe it's a son. He doesn't think it would be fair to ask them to uproot their lives and move, and that's part of why AEW was going to allow him to still live there and travel back and forth every week. And I think that's very noble, right? Everybody has to make decisions in their life that affect other people. And if that factored into his decision to sign with AEW, who I'm sure is still paying him a fuck ton of money, good on Will Ospreay. I don't blame him for that. That sounded like Triple H was a little upset. He couldn't believe that Will Ospreay chose those guys over him and the money that they were offering him. He's a little bothered by that. Too bad. That doesn't mean that this man doesn't grind, doesn't work his ass off, put the work in, the travel. Obviously, I mean, you can't say he half-asses it in the ring. He's the fucking best in the world right now, bell to bell. I'll put him against anybody else. So yes, it was a stupid comment for Triple H to make. Clearly, it was, you know, addressed to him. But Having said that, here we go again. Where you have Will Ospreay come out on television, and the first thing he has to address is a comment that the guy from the other company made about him in an interview that very few people probably even saw. There are some of you watching this right now or listening to this who probably had no idea that Triple H even made those comments. Now you do, because they brought it up on Dynamite. Because they wanted to get that little jab in there. Oh, it's such a good line. All right, cool. Very good. Then he turned his attention to Bryan Danielson and says that many have tried to beat him. Many have failed, except Danielson is a living legend. And so Ospreay can't call himself the greatest in the world until he beats Bryan Danielson. He says, this is AEW. We're the best wrestle, and it's Ospreay's time to show everybody what he's all about, what he brings to the table, and why he is the ace of AEW. Bryan Danielson will find out at Dynasty why his name is Will Ospreay and why he is on another level. Great intensity here from Ospreay. I enjoyed that second half of the promo where he was actually addressing his opponent coming up at the pay-per-view. I mean, what a concept. When he was addressing Bryan Danielson, I thought that part was good. The part about Triple H, it was a nice little dig. Did it need to be on TV? No. It's kind of like the definition of this could have been an email. This could have been a tweet. He could have easily quote tweeted a clip of Triple H on the Pat McAfee show. And that tweet, honestly, would have been seen and shared out by more people than will watch this show tonight. This did not need to be on the television show. We had Lion Hook, Chris Jericho and Hook teaming up tonight with Katsuyori Shibata to take on Shane Taylor, Lee Moriarty, and Anthony Ogogo. I forgot Anthony Ogogo was even employed by this company. We have not seen him in a match on AEW television since 2021. So this was his grand return tonight. Moriarty got taken down very quickly by Jericho, who hit a pretty terrible dropkick before dishing out a series of clotheslines in the corner, and then he hit a corner Hurricane Rana. They went to a break. When they came back from break, Hook delivered a massive overhead suplex to the much bigger Shane Taylor. That actually got a big reaction from the crowd. Shibata made the tag, ran wild with some kicks and chops. Jericho accidentally took a stray shot. He took a stray bullet here from Shibata and got knocked to the floor. Hook wanted to make a tag. Jericho pulls him to the floor, though. And now Hook is like, what the hell are you doing? And Jericho starts talking to him about the learning tree. Remember what I said about the learning tree? So meanwhile, Shibata is in the ring. He sinks a choke in on Moriarty. Shane Taylor comes in. He fires off a right hand. And that led to Lee Moriarty connecting on a suplex flatliner to get the win over Katsuyori Shibata, who has become basically a glorified jobber. He basically is in the Shinsuke Nakamura role in AEW. He certainly lost a lot more than he's won in the last few months. Hook goes to check on Shibata when the match is over. Jericho was upset that they lost, which is pretty fucking ridiculous if you think about it. Hook tells Jericho it didn't have to be like this and told him, get lost. Jericho walked up the ramp. Hook stayed with Shibata and showed him respect. It's a win for Lee Moriarty. Won't mean a damn thing. Won't mean a single thing for Lee Moriarty, because it wasn't about him winning. It was about the cracks in the armor of Lion Hook. Already, there are cracks in the foundation with Chris Jericho and Hook. As far as Anthony Ogogo is concerned, we barely got to see him do anything here. So I can't even sit here and tell you that, he looks so much better than he did the last time I saw him. He's been gone for so long, I don't even remember how good or not he was. I don't think he was that good. He was still very inexperienced. I remember he had a match with Cody. That's pretty much the only thing I remember from Anthony Ogogo's run in AEW. So he didn't do much here. I can't really comment on how he's improved or not improved. But that was the end of that. Renee was in the back with Dustin Rhodes and said Samoa Joe is medically cleared to compete, so their match will happen tonight. And Dustin said this doesn't change his strategy. He still has nothing to lose and has everything to gain. The time for talk is over. Grit, work ethic, passion, and glory. It's what the Rhodes name is all about. And tonight, it will be no different. You know, this is a company that has no issue referencing people, either indirectly or directly, on the other show, right? They did it tonight with CM Punk and Triple H, right? They don't shy away from doing it. So it was a little strange that they didn't really reference or have Dustin talk about his brother at all, or even drop, name drop Cody or anything like that, that he's proud of him or whatever, and then have it feed into the match later on by saying that it's about time that, you know, we had the Rhodes boys at the top of the industry, because if he beats Joe tonight, he would qualify for an eventual shot at the world title. That's what these Eliminator matches are. You know, rankings be damned. So I'm surprised, frankly, that they didn't allow him to do that here, since they don't shy away from it with any other segment. Like the one segment where you could be like, all right, you know what? It was the biggest happening in wrestling like all weekend, that Cody won the title at WrestleMania, right? Everybody's talking about it. That's the one that, you know what? Let's not go there. I just find that funny. We had the Continental Champion, Kazuchika Okada, taking on Cristiano Argento. This was short and sweet. Okada beats him with a Rainmaker. Easy win. After the match, Okada takes the microphone, says he accepts Pac's challenge for Dynasty. And that brings out Pac. walks out, applauds Okada. As he's heading to the ring, he gets attacked by the Young Bucks from behind. The Young Bucks get in the ring, and guess what happened next? Who could have predicted this? The Young Bucks get in the ring, and they are showered by chants of CM Punk. Way to go, boys. Way to go. We'll see if that continues in the weeks to come or if it was a one-night thing. The one thing that you would not want is for the fans to chant for the other guy on your show. I don't care if the Bucks are babyfaces. I don't care if they're heels. I don't care if they're Haces or Beals. You want to combine the two. I don't give a fuck. Congratulations now. You have the people chanting for CM Punk. Way to go. Good job. So the crowd, after they were done doing that, watched the Bucks hit a super kick. Okada lifted Pac for a Rainmaker. FTR, though, came out and made the save. They were slugging it out with the Bucks. FTR wanted the Shatter Machine, but Okada came back with chair shots to drop both of them. The Bucks hit the double EVP trigger to FTR. Okada blasted Pac with a chair shot right to the side of the head. And the Elite were left standing here at the end of this segment. Up next, they had time. You know what? I almost want the fans to continue to chant for CM Punk because I feel like they deserve it. I think they deserve it. Every time the Bucks come out going forward, I want the people to chant for CM Punk. I really do. I want, when they're in there at Dynasty, I want them to chant for CM Punk. Look at this. Look at this. Mantar has been awoken. Even Mantar is so fucking disgusted by what he saw with this footage on the show tonight that he has been awoken. Was that JM? Hey, JM, thank you for the $75. Look at this. You've even disturbed Mantar. You believe this? But that's what I want. I mean, hey, it's fair game, right? You want to put the guy in your television show, then let the fans chant for him. Every single week, I hope they shower these people with chants of CM Punk, at least when the Bucks are out there. Get what they deserve. So up next on stage, it was time for Timeless Toni Storm. And Toni was out there for her Charleston Championship Champagne Toast to One Thunder Rosa. Since they were in Charleston tonight, Renee introduced Thunder Rosa out onto the stage. And then out came Timeless Toni along with Luther. Now, Tony's side of the shot was in black and white. Renee and Rosa, their side of the shot was in color. I like when they do that. Everybody has some champagne. Renee, meanwhile, gives Storm the floor. She immediately tosses the drink in Thunder Rosa's face. Clocks her with Luther's tray. Storm wipes the face paint off of Rosa's face, or tries to. Here comes Deonna Purrazzo. And Deonna comes out from the back. Luther is standing between them. Purrazzo is there to help Rosa. Rosa shoves her off. She doesn't want the assist. And Purrazzo basically says, fuck it, which I think is what she said, and then she leaves. Now on commentary, I forget who it was, but on commentary, somebody said that Thunder Rosa must not have known that it was Deonna who helped. That might be plausible if Thunder Rosa wasn't looking directly at her. Maybe I can buy that. I ain't buying what you're selling. Not unless she's got cataracts in her eyes. So then Mariah May comes out for her match, and Toni gives her a kiss, which seemed to basically, it's like it hulked her up, and now Mariah's all fired up. I'm sure most of the men watching this show now are all fired up too. And here down to the ring comes Mariah May. This would not be the only kiss that Mariah May would receive here on. I don't know what's going on lately. I think Toni is trying. He's trying a lot of different things to pop ratings on this show. He tried something earlier with the footage from 7 months ago, but we've been seeing Mariah May being kissed a lot on these shows. And I would say, hey, okay, whatever, but. Boy, he's really trying. He's trying hard to get people to tune into this show. We had Mariah May one-on-one with Anna Jay. Both women took turns firing off chops. And Anna then turned to forearms, took control for a little bit until Mariah got the advantage back. They end up going to a break. Mariah sidestepped a corner charge, hit a high kick, and then a top rope drop kick connects. Sweet cheek music hits. Anna kicks out. Anna floats over, hits a thrust kick, follows that with a flatliner, gets a near fall. Anna then wants her gory bomb. Mariah, though, rolls through into a flash pin and gets the win. After the match, Anna Jay is very frustrated. And Anna Jay ends up choking out Mariah, or trying to, with her Queen Slayer. Until someone comes out. I didn't realize or recognize at first who it was. But here comes Mina Shirakawa. Yes, the one and only. Mina Shirakawa comes running out to make the save. The most awkward save, because I think there were plenty of people in the building who didn't recognize who this person was. Anna bails out of the ring. She's from Stardom, in case you don't know. So Excalibur talks about how Mariah May and Mina, they were reuniting at Ring of Honor last weekend because they are former tag team partners and stablemates in Stardom. So Shirakawa, she's asking for two glasses of champagne, and she helps Mariah May drink the champagne, and then she plants a kiss. And this was not like a peck on the cheek. She kisses Mariah May for a good 3 or 4 seconds on the lips to try to wake her up. And that got the crowd's reaction. That got people's reaction. Look, Tony Khan, he's going to try what he's going to try to appeal to a certain demographic, I guess, with this show. As far as what they did here, I'm not familiar with Mina Shirakawa. I can appreciate the fact that she has a connection, a past connection with Mariah May. And I understand now that Rossi Ogawa is gone. Tony Khan is going to be working with Stardom. In fact, Stardom will probably have an influence on Forbidden Door this year. If they do Forbidden Door. Apparently Forbidden Door was going to be from Arthur Ashe Stadium in New York. I saw Andrew Zarian report that that is no longer the case. And then Rocky Romero quote tweeted that and said this is not true. But he didn't specify what's not true. Is it not true that they're not running Arthur Ashe? Is it not true that the reason they're not running is because AEW wanted them to, or New Japan, I guess, to kind of chip in on the production expenses, and they said no? I think that's what he was saying was not the case. Whatever's going on with that, I know there were a lot of Stardom fans out there. I don't watch Stardom. I'm not familiar with everybody. I knew of Mariah May before she came to AEW. That's why I was excited to see her come to the United States. And I'm aware of who Julia is. You know, some of the names I'm familiar with, some I am not. This was one of the ones I am not. I can't say that that really does much for me, but as far as this storyline is concerned, perhaps they can weave her involvement into this in such a way where maybe it gets to a point where Mariah has to make a decision about who she's loyal to. Is she loyal to Tony? Is she loyal to Mina? And then that leads to the eventual split with Mariah and Tony. I don't know. I'm just spitballing here. Just help me out. Just follow along. I'm trying to make sense of this. I could see perhaps that being a direction that they go in. Because clearly the eventual direction is going to be Mariah May probably winning the women's title from Toni Storm. I mean, they're going to fight for it. She may win the title from her. That could be the Wembley match, right? Maybe they do that at All In. I don't know how much we're going to see Mina on AEW television, but maybe in the end it'll make sense. We'll see. Alex Marvez was backstage somewhere, sitting down with Mercedes Moné. Mercedes Moné talked about deciding to make history at Double or Nothing. It is now official. She is going to have her first match in an AEW ring on May 26th. We are not going to see Mercedes in the ring until May 26th at Double or Nothing. And I think that's a huge L. If it's an injury reason, a medical reason, she's not officially cleared for a match, then I'm not sure why we had to have her on television so soon. She's been under contract evidently since at least January, possibly even December. She will not have wrestled until the end of May. That's a long period of time. So I don't like that, but if she's not medically cleared, then she's not medically cleared. I have more of an issue with the fact that her first fucking match is going to be for the TBS title. That's one of the reasons why I was hoping we would get her on TV before that. But they went and announced it already. She's getting a title match, her first match in. Did they ever at some point, did I miss something where at some point they stated when she came in, did she make a comment that it was in her contract that she would get a title shot in her first match? I don't recall her saying anything about that. I guess we're just supposed to assume because she's such a big star that she can get a title shot in a company that has rankings. I mean, again, we know they're a fucking joke to begin with. I mean, we already know this. But I have more of an issue with that than anything else. But anyway, now we know when her first match is going to be. So she was asked about the TBS title match at Dynasty between Willow and Julia. And she said, these two women are the very best. Julia Hart is unpredictable. Has Willow's number. Willow is a force to be reckoned with for sure. She's a very dangerous woman. And Alex says, why don't you elaborate on that? Mercedes brings up the match that she had with Willow last year and getting injured. And losing the chance to be the first ever New Japan Strong Women's Champion. She said now she is on a mission to be the TBS champion at Double or Nothing. And she was about to answer on who she wants to face, who she would prefer to face on that show. When the lights went out and you hear in the background, you could hear that somebody, presumably Mercedes, is being beaten up. Alex Marvez is asking for the lights to be turned on, and when they are, Mercedes is down on the ground, and Alex Marvez is asking for help. So that was pretty fucking lame. These segments are unintentionally hilarious, because, and I'm sure he's a nice guy, Alex Marvez is a horrible actor. So when he has to get animated, if there's an attack, oh, get help, or whatever, like just watching him and listening to him is hilarious to me. Acting is not his forte. But there you go. So we're not going to see Mercedes in the ring for another, 7 weeks? I don't know what they're going to have her doing between now and then. Hopefully not commentary. I think she lit the world on fire doing commentary a few weeks ago. But this is also why, you know, why debut her so soon? Why debut her so early? If she's not cleared, if that's the reason. Now, if she is medically clear, because we saw her get physical a few weeks ago. She didn't do much. She hit her finishing move, the moneymaker. That I don't know if that means she's partially cleared, if she's fully cleared. If she's fully cleared, there's no fucking excuse to not have her in a match at Dynasty or on television in the build-up, at least, to Double or Nothing. That's just stupid. So I'm going to assume that she may not be fully healed or fully cleared yet. Why debut her so soon? Is it just Boston? We had that date in Boston. We could only book Boston on that date, and so we have to have her in Boston. I mean, is that what it was? Because that's not a very good excuse. I don't know what they're going to do with her for the next 6 weeks, but hopefully it's better than what they did with her tonight. Then we had the main event. We had a Samoan named Joe against a member of the Rhodes family. Am I watching WrestleMania or am I watching Dynamite? This was a world title eliminator match. So if Dustin wins, then he will have earned himself a future shot at the AEW world title. We don't know when, but he would have a future title shot in his back pocket. Joe comes out with Swerve Strickland's chain, limping to the ring, as Dustin attacks right at the bell with strikes in the corner. Joe tossed Dustin outside the ring and then drove him, into the barricade. Dustin fought back. Joe was back in control pretty quickly after that. He posted Dustin. And of course, it's Dustin Rhodes. And so he is a bloody mess. Dustin is busted open. And all during the break, it was all Samoa Joe. Dustin is trying to fight back. He doesn't have his equilibrium because he's a bloody mess. Joe just keeps raining down shots until Dustin fired off a snap power slam. Dustin hits a code red for a two count. Joe dodges a bulldog and he clobbers Dustin with a lariat that sends him to the floor. Joe tried to post him again. This time Dustin turned the tables and sent Joe into the post. And then he tosses the AEW World Title belt into the ring. And the referee is in there and the referee is pleading with Dustin, don't do it. Because he'll be disqualified and he won't be able to get a future title shot. Don't do it. He's telling him, don't do it. Dustin puts the title down. And then he boots Joe. And then Dustin Rhodes hits a crossroads. And then he goes for the pin. He gets a very close two count. See, now, if he would have studied his brother, if he would have watched WrestleMania, then he would know. As Roman Reigns said, when Roman Reigns used the crossroads, what did Roman Reigns say? He goes, that move sucks. You're not beating anybody with that move. Right? He would know he's got to hit it three times. You hit it three times, you can win. He obviously wasn't paying attention. And Dustin was there, by the way. He was at WrestleMania because there was a picture in the back. He was in the picture. QT Marshall was there. Ricky Starks was there. I don't know that Dustin was in the crowd. If he was, I'm sure somebody would have taken a picture. So he must have been either in a box or in the back somewhere. Anyway, the one crossroads didn't get the job done. Joe goes to the corner. He suckers Dustin in. And he hits him with an STO. Joe grabs the chain. Referee takes it away. That allows Joe, with the referee's attention diverted, to blast Dustin with the AEW World title. Joe makes the cover. He steals the win. A cheap win for the AEW World title. Or a world champion, rather. After the match is over, Joe sinks in the Coquina clutch. Here comes Swerve Strickland out of nowhere with a house call kick. Strickland grabs the chain. He levels Joe with a punch. Strickland tries to whip Joe with it, but he bails. And Prince Nana presents the AEW World title to Swerve, who holds the belt up in the air and stares down a very pissed off Samoa Joe as they go off the air. The only thing missing here was the lights going out in the middle of the match. And then when the lights come back on, we have The Undertaker in the middle of the ring. And then he chokeslams Samoa Joe. But see, I guess we already had the lights go out twice on this show. We had the lights go out earlier, and then Julia Hart was in the ring. We had the lights go out in the back, and somebody beat up Mercedes. I mean, there's a quota here. You can only have the lights go out so many times on one show. But none of this matters. I mean, it almost doesn't even matter what I say here about this segment. I could sit here and say, all right, it was a fine segment here to move things along with Swerve and Joe going into their match at Dynasty. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't even matter because nobody is going to be talking about Samoa Joe and Swerve Strickland coming out of this show tonight. Tony Khan made sure of that. Nobody is going to be talking about any of this shit. They're going to be talking about Brawl In. So it makes me wonder, you know, as I sit here and I say that, and I think about Swerve Strickland, and I think about Samoa Joe, and I think about Copeland. Well, I guess we know how Adam Copeland feels, right? Everything's just a bed of roses. But you think about all the other people on this show, all the people going into the pay-per-view in 10 days, I believe it is. How do they feel about this? And I don't mean like publicly, what they would tweet or what they would say in a podcast, you know, publicly. Like deep down, what must they be thinking when they see that Tony Khan is going to be airing all-in footage of CM Punk on this show tonight? What are they thinking now that the show is over and that people are going to be talking about CM Punk and Jack Perry and the Young Bucks and Brawl In and something that happened 7 months ago? I can't imagine that they're going to be happy about this. I can't imagine that it makes them go, man, this is one of the reasons why I'm proud to be an AEW, right? This is a great moment for AEW. You got to give it right back to him, right? You got a pay-per-view coming up in 10 days. First ever, Dynasty. Got some big matches on that show. Got Bryan Danielson against Will Ospreay for the very first time. I wonder what those guys are thinking right now. Would Bryan Danielson have made that decision? If he heard the comments that Punk made on Ariel Helwani's show, and we know how much respect Tony Khan has for Bryan Danielson. Tony Khan has said that he told his father, if anything ever happens to him, if he gets hit by a bus one day, Cody's bus accidentally runs him over, that he wants Bryan Danielson to take over. You think Bryan Danielson would make the same call? Because I don't. Not for a second. It's sad. It really is sad that we sit here and this is the state of this company at this point, that they are struggling ratings-wise when there are a lot of things to be happy about. A lot of talent on the roster. They've got what they hope is a renewal coming soon with Warner Brothers Discovery. Tony Khan talks about it like it's almost a done deal. Like they're going to get a huge rights increase from Warner Brothers Discovery, and he's always very positive about the future when it comes to that. that could very well be the difference between this company going from not being profitable to being profitable. You know, for their sake, I hope it happens. They have a lot of people that they employ. The wrestling business is better off for having a strong number two instead of, you know, basically what we had for so long in Impact, which for a while there was the only other serious game in town. And they haven't been taken seriously as a television property since they got kicked off Spike TV. I don't care how talented the roster is. You saw the drop-off from where they used to be to where they are now. It's sad. You need to have a strong second promotion. And I want them to do well, but when they make boneheaded decisions like this, it just is fucking, it's frustrating. It's very frustrating. It's a self-own. They do it to themselves. I don't know what else to say that hasn't already been said. What happened on this show tonight, elsewhere, doesn't even matter. And that's the saddest part of all. Here's the Twitter poll. That says it all right there. I mean, if that result doesn't say what needs to be said, then I don't know what does. Thumbs up gets 16%, thumbs in the middle 14, and just shy of 70%. 7-0. With 3,000 votes in and counting. 70% thumbs down for this Dynamite show tonight. You would hope that someone like Tony Khan can learn, as a student of the game that he says he is, a savant, if you would, that he would learn from history, he would learn from the mistakes of others, he would learn from the mistakes made by companies like WCW. Tonight was not a vote of confidence in that direction. Yeah, that's right. As you can see from the poll here, the fans have 69 AEW. I just realized that. Took me a second there. But they are rocking a 69 right now. Unbelievable. Thank you, by the way, to everybody who has dropped a super chat. I did pause them there, so a lot of them are delayed. They're going to be rolling on in. And I'm going to read through them. I'm sure you guys have a lot of opinions on this tonight as well. Probably a lot of you agreeing, some of you maybe not. That's okay, as long as you disagree respectfully. But thank you to all of our new subscribers. Again, we cracked 79,000 overnight, and so we are marching towards 80K. I cannot do that without you, so let's begin the journey. Let's begin the journey together, like FIFO's werewolf. I like that name. Thank you. Welcome to the channel. I'm going to start here with the early super chats, which are not the ones that you see on screen. We'll get to those in a second, but the earlier ones here came in beforehand. So I want to make sure I start with those first. Base Beerus says they did it. Props to them for delivery. Well, one thing they did do, they did not do a bait and switch. If there's one positive thing I can say, I'm not even sure it's all that positive, but look, they promoted something and they delivered on it. They didn't do a bait and switch. I almost kind of wish they would have, but it's good when you advertise something to at least give people what you told them you were going to give them. So that might be the only positive I can say about it. But yes, it was not a bait and switch. Prince Vegeta. Showing this footage just shows that the snowman can't take criticism and he's not a boss. Just like Phil said, how pathetic. And I don't care about seeing Jungle Bitch on my TV. He is not a star. CM Punk, for all of his faults, there was some harsh truth that he spoke in that interview with Ariel Helwani. And when he talked about AEW not being a real business, I disagreed with that because you see all that AEW has done in 5 years. There's never been another wrestling promotion that has had that level of success that they've had in a five-year span, just starting out, right? That's impressive, and I will give them their props for it. Absolutely. It is a business, but it is a business that is operating under a model that just doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. But what Punk said about Tony Khan, you know, being a clown and you're not a real boss, you know, when you see stuff like that, which again is one of the things that puzzles me about why they thought that airing this footage would be to their benefit. It doesn't exactly show Tony Khan being a boss now, does it? All that did was reinforce what CM Punk said. And every step of the way in this process, when he says he went to Toni and he said to Toni there, you better do something about this. And Toni said, what do you want me to do? Step up. Be a boss. Put your foot down. Make it very well known to everybody that in that locker room that it's your way or the highway. You're the boss. You run the show. He doesn't want to do that. I don't know if it's because he's afraid. I don't know if it's because he's intimidated. I don't know if it's just because he's trying to buddy up and be friendly with people and he doesn't want to get on their bad side. It might be that. It might just be he wants to be more of a friend than anything else. But that point that CM Punk made, I think that point maybe more than anything is what really stuck in Tony Khan's craw. And what led to what we saw tonight, airing that footage. Hearing you're a clown and you're not a real boss, that stung. That had to sting Tony Khan. And he reacted. This was a very reactionary thing. On that point, CM Punk was correct. I don't think that can be in dispute. Kentucky Dried Chicken without flavor. I'm going to say it right now. Despite seeing the footage, it's too late for AEW to change my mind. I am still siding with CM Punk. He warned AEW twice. Oh, JM is coming in hot. JM is coming in hot, which is good. I need to cool the temperature down here just a little bit.
We're having a party here on the street. We're Barry Horowitz now. Where is
he? Hey, JM, man. Holy shit. Thank you for the $200 super chat bomb there. Very much appreciated. Rent free. Tama in the chat says rent free. That's how it comes across. CM Punk continues to live rent-free in Tony Khan's head. And that's sad. That's very sad. Carl the Crab. Shivani was having WCW flashbacks. When they cut back to the announce desk, Punk, Tony Khan, and Jack acted like idiots in the situation. Can we move on now? I would certainly hope so. The Winston Slip. Dustin's theme sounds like Brain Stew by Green Day. I didn't even notice. Kentucky Look, Dried Chicken. If I was the boss,
bro.
If I was the boss of AEW and CM Punk asked me to handle that situation, I'm getting the security team to avoid escalating a potential situation. You don't even need to get the security team. This is what I mean. You don't even need to worry about getting the security team involved. You simply pull Jack Perry aside and have a conversation with him about it. You know, he made a comment into the camera. What I would do in a situation like that, because honestly, even that, I'm not suspending him. I'm not firing him for that. Okay, CM Punk has done far worse than that in his career. People pop for it. You know, he made comments on TV all the time, pissing people off. Jack Perry is not as big of a star as CM Punk. So what you do is you pull him aside and say, look, talk to me. What is that all about? I know Punk was a little upset by it. What's going on here? Hear what he has to say, and then say, look, don't do that, okay? We're trying to do something here, something special. We need to work together as a team, right? So can we not do that, please? Let's avoid these types of situations. I don't want to hear about this. I don't want to see this again. And that would have been it. That would have been it. That's what I'm talking about. And if Jack Perry says no, or if Jack Perry talks back to his boss or cusses him out like he supposedly was cussing out Shivani and Mike Mansuri on the production team and everything. That's what Punk said back when they did the whole spot with the, well, he wanted to do the real glass spot with the car on collision. If that's the reaction that Jungle Boy has, then you can tell Jungle Boy to climb his vine and he could take his ass somewhere else. But all you need to do is sit down and have a conversation. Why are these people incapable of sitting down and having a conversation? Why? Is it the generation that we're in where people don't talk face-to-face? They just text or they tweet? Why is it so hard for Tony Khan to get people in a room or get them to sit down and talk and have a fucking conversation? I swear to God, I don't understand it. All of this shit could be avoided by that. Because once you have the conversation, if this shit continues, that's when you start cracking heads and suspending people. And fining people or firing people. That's your one warning. And if they can't control themselves, if they can't behave themselves, if you're CM Punk and you can't keep your fucking hands to yourself, you're gone. If you're Jack Perry and you can't listen to what you're being told to do, you're gone. Why is this so hard? I don't understand. I really don't. I don't understand. Ross Lawmed showing the footage was Russo level embarrassing. Damn it, Dan. Thank you for the $20. What the fuck was that? I don't even hate AEW, but come on, that stunt was pathetic. I hope Dynasty does well for their sake, by the way. Buy or sell on best overall wrestler, Kevin Owens or Eddie Kingston. Keep up the great work. I love them both, but I go KO. You're talking best overall wrestler, Kevin Owens, his matches, I think. I would put above Eddie Kingston's. I've seen more Kevin Owens matches that I would consider to be of a higher quality than Eddie Kingston's matches. So as a wrestler, I would go KO, but I think Kingston is great. You know, he's got an authenticity to him that very few people in wrestling have. That counts for a lot with me. Kentucky Dry Chicken says, I wonder what David Zaslav and Warner Brothers Discovery is thinking right now after that All In security footage being aired on national TV. I'm sure they're fine with it because it aired on their network. If they were going to have an issue with it and it was announced days ago, then it would not have aired. So I'm sure they're fine with it. Anything to get the ratings up. Joey with the five. Do you think Tony Khan and the Bucks were cussing out Tony Schiavone and the doctor when they told them not to air the footage? No, I don't. Dr. Bropio, congrats on AEW winning the first ever Sound Off Sad promotion of the week. For real though, AEW should have just focused on building towards Dynasty. Prince Vegeta says, that shit is as bad as Immortal and Fortune era in TNA. I thought you were going to say aces and eights. Ace of Masta, a Rhodes losing to the superior Samoan named Joe. Let me back this up here, see how far back this goes. Thank you, brother. Thank you for the message. I appreciate it. Again, I'm going to read through all of you. Oh, man, it's a lot here. I'm going to read through all of your messages here, but I want to rewind it to the beginning. So where we pick up with it is going to be with Austin. We'll get to Austin's super chat here in a second. Hey, hey, Ray, welcome to the channel. Thank you for the sub. As we march towards 80K. Arabian Knight says, if Triple H got to pick one wrestler from AEW to join WWE not named MJF, who would he want? I think Samoa Joe or the guy that I feel he wanted, Adam Cole. I think you're right. I think Triple H was very upset to lose Adam Cole. He pushed him hard. He knew the kind of worker he was. He knew the kind of promo he was. He knew the value he brought to the company. I think he really would want Adam Cole back. He loved Samoa Joe. When Samoa Joe got fired, what did he do? He brought him to NXT. He rehired him. But I also think he wanted Will Ospreay, and that's why he made the comment he did. I think he was genuinely bothered. That was his way of kind of lashing out at losing Will Ospreay by making that comment that he made on McAfee's show. Chris Miner, buy or sell, WWE's ECW or AEW's Ring of Honor? I'm not really that big of a fan of either one, to be honest with you. If I had to choose one, I would go AEW's Ring of Honor because they have the stronger pay-per-views. Just like match quality-wise, blows away that version of ECW. My cat is a demon. Are you okay? You need some help? I just don't understand what this achieved. This did not prove Punk lied or showed us anything that we didn't already know. It just handed WWE fuel to dump on the McIntyre and Punk feud. Oh my God. Drew McIntyre is going to have a fucking field day with this. I actually can't wait to see what he comes up with now. I think McIntyre is going to have a field day with this now. This journey called life. That Wembley segment just proved Tony's downfall. Sam Rizza, I love wrestling and I have ideas for angles and promos, etc. doesn't mean I can book or run a promotion. Tony Khan got AEW up and running. Now it is time he stepped aside and let better people run it. Well, I hear Scott D'Amore is available. Dan Richards, this was their finger poke of doom moment, multiplied by their Hogan work shoot Jeff Jarrett laydown moment. Anyone who thought this was smart, fire them. I don't think Tony is going to fire himself. His call. It was his call to make. It's all at his feet. Zach Goller, I take back any bad word I ever said about CM Punk. That footage was embarrassing. I can't believe the pettiness. Real CS says, the only good thing to come out of this embarrassment is that Drew has got more material for his feud with CM Punk. Yeah, I mean, they did McIntyre a huge favor. I'll say that. He's going to have a field day with it. Let's see who's in that. Man, there's so many here. And again, I thank you guys for all the support. You guys, really going back to WrestleMania, have blown me away with all the support. And it's been a lot of work over the past week. A lot of short nights, but man, it's been a lot of fun hanging out with you guys. James, with the $10 super chat, says, singing, look in my eyes, what do you see? Security, look calm to me. Tony Khan needs ratings, don't you agree? That's why the tape is from Wembley. Oh, the Bucks lack personality. Don't quit your day job, James. Thank you for the 10 bucks. I don't think that record's going to go gold any day soon. Austin Blansett says, this is generational levels of pettiness. AEW at this current moment in time is a lot like TNA from 2007 to 2017, except news won't bury them, obviously. The Juliet says, rest in peace, Akebono, at the age of 54. Is that true? I did not hear that. That is sad to hear. Rest in peace to Akebono. Still, one of my most horrid memories from WrestleMania is watching him and Big Show when Big Show got knocked out of the ring and I saw in that kimono or whatever he was wearing, and I saw way too much of Big Show. I saw more of him than I ever care to see in my entire life. El Prezcat, WCW 2000 or AEW 2024, buy or sell. AEW 2024. I feel like the people who say that didn't actually live through and watch WCW in 2000. Carl the Crab. Looks like AEW is copyright striking in-arena footage taken by fans of them chanting Punk and cheering him. Just an embarrassing moment for AEW. Like I said, they've opened the floodgates now to potential CM Punk chants on TV every single week, and I hope it happens. When the Bucks walk out there, they should be showered in chants of CM Punk from here until the end of time. Because, again, this was a very stupid decision, and if you're going to dredge up the past, then you have to be prepared to deal with the consequences of that. So I hope the fans throw it right back at them. Michael, with the 1999, Tony Khan should have Samoa Joe drop the belt to David Arquette next week on Dynamite. I'm sure that would pop a number. Don't give them any ideas. They may get Paul Walter Hauser to come back and win the title from Samoa Joe. They had him at the Ring of Honor pay-per-view last week. William Sanchez, the best part of the Brawl In footage is what Drew McIntyre is going to give us out of it. In all seriousness, this was a desperate, pathetic joke by AEW. Ken, the look on Shivani's face before and after the footage tells a story of its own. I feel for the guy. Yeah, I mean, he had a look on his face even before they threw it to the footage, but it was clear as day when they came back to the announcers after it was over. I mean, he's another one. You know, I asked the question before, Bryan Danielson, for example, who's on the disciplinary committee and has a lot of respect from Tony Khan. If it was him, do you think he would have aired the footage? The answer is no. If Tony Schiavone was asked about this, do you think he would have said, yeah, we should air the footage? I don't believe that for a second. He knows. He knows better than most. We got Whiteface here with the $4.99. AEW is now doing copyright takedowns on Twitter of people sharing clips of footage aired on their own show. Talk about instant regret. Well, they've always been very strict about that. So I don't know that that's necessarily a new thing. My cat is a demon with the $3. Just a heads up, don't post the footage to your Twitter or YouTube. AEW is currently purging it off the internet through copyright strikes. Yeah, no, that's a no-no, especially on YouTube, as far as posting actual video. But boy, yeah, it looks like maybe they are having some regret. Maybe. Well, you know what? It's a mess of their own making. Joshua Edwards, haven't done a super chat in months and just wanted to stop by for a minute. Thanks for feeding families, Solo. Yeah, you're very welcome. Justin G, will AEW edit the video, zoom in on Punk like the Z-Pack? No. There may be more footage, who knows? I mean, Toni talked about fearing for his life. I thought that that was a separate thing where Punk came to find him, or he went to go meet with Punk after, and something may have happened in private. Again, if that was the moment where he feared for his life, I mean, look, him going on television in the first place and saying that was so fucking ridiculous. And just was it was hilarious. Like, why he even thought that would be something that he should be saying on TV. It just made him look like such a fool to even admit that. I've never feared ever in my life as much as I did at that exact moment. You break. D. James, can't wait for the Punk Perry match at Oh, wait. Yeah. Boy, you would think that they were getting Punk and Perry ready for a big match at Dynasty. I guess we're not getting that match. That's too bad. I'm all hyped up for it. River Serenity Verona. CM Punk is a ratings draw in two wrestling companies at the same exact time. Truly a generational talent. That's right. CM Punk appeared on Raw on Monday night, and he appeared on Dynamite tonight. The guy's all over the place. Corey Blake. AEW just sabotaged their upcoming pay-per-view with their silly BS. Once again, lack of leadership hurts the company. By the way, thanks for the great work, Solo. You're very welcome, Corey. Thank you for the support. Lalo, WCW 2K, biggest own goal in AEW history. Embarrassing. Bernard, hey Solo, do you think with all these shenanigans, the shine is effectively off of AEW? Just comes off as so minor league and embarrassing to me. I mean, the new car smell has been off for a while. So when you say the shine, AEW has been getting a lot of hate for a long time, including from people who just hate it for the sake of hating it. Not even when there's good reason to hate on certain things. They've been getting hate for a while, so I would say the shine has been off a lot longer than this. That's not new. Tonic Blaze, that show was fucking embarrassing. Toni Khan has proven Punk right that he is not a boss. He is a big-ass kid with money, and he needs to get his shit together. I don't know why he would have expected the reaction to be any different. This journey called life. But you know what? Emotion. When you get upset about something, emotion, it makes you do some very stupid things sometimes. Emotion made Toni Khan do a very stupid thing tonight. He says AEW even pulled out of Arthur Ashe Forbidden Door. Well, I talked about that. That was an Andrew Zarian report. They were going to run there. Apparently now they are not. So we'll see where the new location is going to be. Apparently it costs a lot of money to run there. And I think the fact that if they did pull out of Arthur Ashe because of the expense of running there, I think that says a lot. I think that says a lot. If you got Toni Khan admitting in the scrum the other day that he overspent more than he had planned coming into this year, then he's feeling the pinch. Merlot Williams said it 100 times. AEW is a vanity project for three guys and their friends, funded by a money mark who thinks he is friends with the wrestlers. Punk is 100% right and handled it like old school wrestlers did. I disagree on that last point. Just because old school wrestlers would do that does not make it right. If you're trying to run a business, CM Punk talks about running a business, right? Then you got to run a business the right way. You don't run a business the right, you can't have your cake and eat it too. You can't talk out of both sides of your mouth. If you think that Tony Khan is a clown, he's not a real boss, you're entitled to that opinion. If you think CM Punk had a right to be upset, absolutely, that's fine. You can't say, well, in the old days, this is how it would have been done, so I fully support CM Punk putting his hands on Jack Perry. No, if you're going to run a real business, then you got to run it the real way. I don't know of any real businesses that would stand for something like that. So, again, you can't have it both ways. But, Merlot, thank you. The other points I think you make are valid. Magician Sapphire. The Brawl-In footage was a huge embarrassment for Tony Khan and AEW. Poor Tony Schiavone looked absolutely sick on commentary after the segment. Enough is enough. This is not the AEW of old. No, it is not. Anderson Blitz, seeing Solomonster ranting at AEW reminds me of the old dark days of WWE from the late 2010s. The difference between WWE and AEW this week is amazing. Just telling it like it is. Food Hive, disappointed in Tony Khan tonight. El Masse, with the $40 CM Punk Super Chat. Is this the first time a legit backstage altercation has been aired on TV? First one that I can remember. We had the curtain call air on TV, but that wasn't a backstage brawl. Tuxedo T Servo, for fuck's sake, Tony Khan sounds like a school kid sending his friends out to talk him up, Copeland, or fight by proxy with the Bucks and that footage. Grow, shut the fuck up, and move on. Ragnarok, boy, you know, I'll tell you something right now. We are sitting here days, right? 72 hours, I guess it's more than that by now, 72 hours or so, after Cody Rhodes had the biggest moment of his life, the biggest moment of his career, and won the world title in the main event of WrestleMania and ended Roman's run. And then days later, we have this shit show that we saw tonight on Dynamite. I don't think Cody has ever felt more than he probably does right now that he got out at the exact right time. What is he thinking right now? He's probably thinking to himself, boy, I'm glad I'm not in that fucking place anymore. As he sits there with his big-ass belt in his lap. Boy, did he make the right call. Ragnarok. That entire segment was the drizzling shits. And AEW should feel bad for airing that video and thinking it will do anything positive for them. C-Dust. Jim Cornette is going to have a field day. I feel like he's been having a field day from the moment that the first brawl happened. Dr. War God with the $10. Tony Khan needs to be careful, as this could be the AEW version of the finger poke of doom in terms of turning fans away from the product. Keep up the good work. And Jade too. That's right, JR. That's right. Dr. War God, thank you very much. Uffman Entertainment. April 10th, 4:10. Happy Bret Hart Day. I didn't even realize. Yeah, Bret Hart gives that segment a 4 out of 10. Dan Richards, I disagree. Firing Punk was easy and justified. The hard thing was to deal with Jack Perry before Punk dealt with it. Tony Khan has most of the blame. River Serenity Verona with the $4.99. Samoa Joe and House of Black hung out with Punk after All In and ate Nando's together. They were unfazed about what happened with Jungle Boy. Truly hilarious. Dev to Dust. Johnny Gargano looks like Tom Cruise. First time I've ever heard that before. Johnny Gargano looks like Tom Cruise. I think Tom Cruise is a little bit taller than him, though, no? MH Nova, do you think if the footage was released the week after All Out, would it hit differently? Also, I want to see Brawl Out. I think it would have hit differently. I do. There was a lot of curiosity about it. It was fresh in people's minds, and it led to their biggest star being fired. A lot of people had a lot of questions at that time. Is it justified? Why would you do that? Why would you get rid of your top name? So I think that it would have hit differently if it would have aired, let's say, the week after. Rodimus Prime. After the nonsense tonight, it overshadowed what I thought was a decent show. Tony Khan and the Bucks did themselves no favors. Embarrassing. And Rodimus says, the look on Tony's face told the whole story. I would feel the same way if I were him. Beyond pathetic. Chris AXC, has the AEW product been colder? Falling into the same traps TNA did years ago? Which ex-WWE talent wishes they were back there after Mania and tonight's mess? Oh, I'm sure there's more than a few. You can't convince me that there aren't more than a few who were looking at this going, man, what the fuck have I gotten myself into here, being a part of this? As the man himself. Hey, Jacob, thank you for the sub. Welcome to the channel. You picked a good night. Or a bad night, I guess, depending on how you look at it. MH Nova says, seems like Tony and the Bucks are more concerned with Punk than Drew actually should be. Going from the most sentimental moments to the most controversial. Joseph Brooks, it may be too early and I may be going too far, but are you feeling WCW 2000s vibes with the way that AEW aired that clip? Vibes, yes. And that is not a place that, believe me, that is not a place that AEW wants to be. There is no positive to giving off WCW 2000s vibes. River Serenity Verona, all this does is increase Punk's popularity. Mainstream WWE fans and the NXT and main roster women love him. He's living his best life. Thank you. Brian Anthony Rivers, this is AEW's Hell in a Cell 2019. Oh my God, don't remind me of that. Mother of all rants with that show. Andrew McGurn, if Tony was a boss, it would have been handled before All In. Punk was wrong, but Tony knew this shit was brewing and did exactly nothing to fix it. That's right. JM with that $75 Mantar drop. I just saw the end of that Mariah May match with Mina Shirakawa solo. I now see why you are a huge Mariah May fan, bro. I'm a huge Mariah May fan. And you should be too. Mariah May is great. Anderson Blitz. Hey JM, thank you again for the $75. Anderson Blitz, AEW is so pathetic that they are trying to take down posts from people on TikTok and YouTube that are talking about it, as my post on TikTok was taken down. Bender McSimpson, a $9.99 super chat here. Solo, just wanted to say thanks for all your hard work over WrestleMania weekend. You had a great idea, and I agree. AEW needs more backstage segments without the interviewer and just the wrestlers. That was the point that I made on the podcast the other day. I said, look, I'm not saying that they should just copy everything that WWE does, but that's where you get a lot of character development on those shows. You don't, it's not like the stand-up backstage interview. It's the interactions, let's say in someone's locker room, people sitting down, they're having a conversation. That's really where you can progress stories and you can develop characters. And AEW has so many of them that I feel like they're missing out by not doing segments like that. Retro KOH, it wasn't even a real choke. It was a front face lock. Kind of like how Jericho took down Bill Goldberg. AEW is a joke. Joey Jojo Jr. says, after showing this on TV, AEW can never have a backstage brawl or attack again. I love hot barbecue with the $10. The only thing it accomplishes is to give Drew a new reference to make on Twitter. Yeah, I mean, it's only a matter of time, isn't it? Barry MK, DJ Woo Kid is the worst name I have ever heard. I'm pretty sure it was DJ Woo Kid who was backstage at All In, though. I think he was the one. Bobby's World with the 10 says, what I appreciate more than anything else is your ability to see things with an open mind. Something of a great deal of podcasters and streamers fail to possess. Respect to you, brother. Well, Bobby, I try. There's still people who disagree with you because they only see it one way or the other. It's one way or the other, and that's it. There's no in between. You got to pick sides. This person was, you know, this person's an idiot. This person's, you know, completely innocent. No one is completely innocent in this. I don't care what anybody says. Retro, as silly as this overreaction by Tony Khan of the Bucks was, Punk should not have put his hands on him. River Serenity says, Danhausen, post a GIF on Twitter in support of Punk after tonight's show. This company is washed. All Punk's friends in AEW were supportive of him. Yeah, I mean, look, when you had FTR go out there and say what they did, they were supposed to, but I'm sure they really feel that way. They're probably thinking the same thing. Why are we doing this? What are you hoping to accomplish by this? I guarantee you, they're thinking the same thing. Bobby's World says, also, shout out to all the mods. They had their work cut out for them tonight. Yeah, shout out to all of our mods. Merlot Williams, Punk knows wrestling's carny roots. He handled it old school. Don't hear this righteous indignation when Brett yanking Shawn's hair out comes up. Oh, so I should go on rant about something that happened 25 years ago now? Now you're grasping at straws. Now you're grasping at straws and bending over backwards to defend CM Punk. And I get it, you're a fan of his, that's cool. But this is what I mean when you can't see things through your own fandom. This is what happens. It's one way or the other. That's not how life works, Merlot. I'm sorry. I'm happy to give you that life lesson. That's not how life works. And if you have to pull examples out from 20 and 30 years ago to try to make a point, you've already lost the argument. Fallen Exposure. Where was Dustin's shield tonight? Yeah, I don't know. I thought Dustin was friends with Keith Lee, but I guess he's not around these days. Chris Manson with the $9.99. Can't let you get close, but Punk went up to him and cheap shotted him while Jack was fixing his hair. He was fixing his hair. He was not being aggressive. He looked like he was getting ready for a photo shoot. More than he was getting ready to fix for a fight. To be honest, he says, I don't feel any different about AEW. I am just here with my popcorn. People need to relax. Project Libertad. Tony better put all of his chips on Mina because she saved this show after that awful backstage video. Deontay Soigne. I agree, let's move forward. Loved Mina Shirakawa on Dynamite, wanted stardom on the show forever, and what a segment with Mariah. All love Solo. Is Keith Lee hurt? I think Keith Lee has been hurt from the day he walked into the company. I don't know what's going on with Keith Lee. I wish him well, I hope he heals up, but it's been a bust so far. No cap, I did not enjoy Triple H punching down. Tony lashes out on his show weekly, it's sad. Tony only has his company because of his father. Yeah, and again, to go back to Merlot's point, when you're pulling hair in a backstage brawl, nobody looks good there either. So, I don't think I've even ever talked about that fight in a way where I was taking sides. So, yes, I agree. That was a very stupid thing to do. Shawn Michaels, of course, was a complete douchebag back then anyway. But the idea of them pulling each other's hair out is actually more hilarious to me than anything else. As I recall that story, I believe it was in the men's room. And I think Jerry Lawler had to get involved and Pat Patterson had to get involved. The idea that you have these two men in the bathroom, both with long hair, pulling each other's hair out like a cat fight, is actually very funny. Pathetic, but very funny. However, I will say, Bret Hart punching Vince McMahon in the face, he warned him. He did warn him. And Bret already knew he was gone anyway. So, it's hard to say that Vince didn't know he had that coming when Bret said, look, I'm going to go take a shower, and if you're still here when I come out, I'm going to knock you out. And that's what he did. NBA DeCali. Herb Abrams walked so Tony Khan can run a wrestling company down the ground like he did tonight. We have JM with that $200 bomb from earlier. $200. I think Triple H and Tony Khan should learn to not let the old NXT AEW Wednesday night scuffle and all of the little barbs traded over the years get to them personally before they wind up as jabroni marks without a life that don't know it's a work when you work a work and work yourself into a shoot, Marks. Sage words. Sage words from the legendary Hulk Hogan. Still so sad he deleted that tweet, but it will live on in infamy nonetheless. Hey, JM, thank you. Thank you for working that in there, by the way. The Moldy Cheeseburger says, how the hell did we get from Cody winning the WWE Undisputed Championship to airing Dirty Laundry on AEW? Tony Khan set himself up for failure. Barry MK, maybe Dustin didn't say much about Cody since AEW was so stuck in the past. Maybe they don't even know Cody just won the biggest match of his life. Oh, they know. They're all very much aware. They were all watching. Some of them were actually there in the building that night. River Serenity Verona. Danhausen is openly defending Punk from Tony Khan and the Elite on Twitter and is openly mocking Jack Perry on Instagram. I love this timeline. Danhausen and Punk are very close. They're very good friends. And Danhausen clearly has been very frustrated with AEW for a while. I don't even need to hear him say it. You can just see it in his tweets and some of the things on social media. There's a passive aggressiveness that's been there because I think he just wishes he was being used more. And he's not being used more. And so Danhausen may be at the point where he just don't give a fuck. That may be where he is. Nick Grasso. This company embarrassed themselves tonight. First the video footage they should not have aired. Then FTR gives a hollow rally the troops speech after that Ospreay. Then takes a petty jab at Triple H. And to top it off, Joe versus Rhodes. Yeah, it's ridiculous. Nick, thank you. Mario DeRose says, why are the Bucks and Jack Perry such snowflakes? You just want to punch them in the face. Barry MK says, looks like AEW is now copyright striking people showing the Punk and Perry video that they just aired. We've been getting a lot of messages about that. Pillow v. Pillow, my father passed away on Sunday. Thank you for providing me with some form of distraction. I'm very sorry to hear that. My condolences to you and your family. Really not much to say in a situation like that other than thinking about you, and you've got a whole community of people here that you can... you can hang out with and count on. So I'm very sorry to hear that. International Channel for Life. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. You can be boxed in a corner so much until you do something stupid. Fans wanted this. Hugh Jazz. Hard to believe how pathetic AEW has become. We've got Kentucky Fried Chicken without flavor. You're not wrong, Solomonster. You have every right to call out Punk's actions. I'm still siding with Punk. Hate me. Agree to disagree. Lesser of two evils. Punk warned Tony. I don't hate you. There's no hate for me. We can agree to disagree. But I think we can all agree that this should have been handled long before any of this even happened. And that all starts with one person. Christian Ray, Drew is going to have a fucking field day with this. Dylan Hensley with the $5. Just wanted to update you. I'm currently 4 matches into my pro wrestling career as RD Beats. And I'm currently 0-3 as my first match was in a battle royal. Well, you know what you're going to have to start doing. You're going to have to start pulling the tights. Giving a low blow here and there. Brass knucks. Got to do whatever it takes, man. Got to start winning some matches. Do whatever you need to do. Isaac, When Jack Perry returns to AEW, if he returns, should Tony Khan license Cry Me a River by Justin Timberlake for his entrance? I think we should just move on past this. That's what I think we should do. Kentucky Dried Chicken says, if AEW wants to do better, the Bucks have to be removed as EVPs. Tony Khan needs to step down as head booker and hire Scott D'Amore as EVP. And then when you wake up, let me know, because that's not going to happen. Hey, look, you know, one thing that I find funny that people who disagree with me or hate on me never bring up is the fact that after Brawl Out, when Brawl Out, forget Brawl In, when Brawl Out first happened, I don't want to get my fights mixed up. Who was the one who said that the Bucks should be stripped of their EVP status? This guy. I've always said that. After what happened at Brawl In, they should have been stripped of their EVP status. People ignore that fact. How come you never say that the Bucks shouldn't be under any sort of, punishment or penalty for what happened? I thought I was pretty clear when I said that 2 years ago. All it does is create problems. When you start mixing, you have talent as executives in the company. I mean, you're just asking for trouble. Now, if they want to become EVPs in the company when they retire, cool. But in this situation, I think you're just asking for problems. And we see how the whole thing blew up. So I don't disagree that I don't think the Bucks should be EVPs in the company, even though they did help found the company. But Tony Khan is not going to turn around now 2 years later and strip them of their EVP title. I'm not even sure how that would work. I don't know how it's built into their contracts. They just negotiated a new contract with Barry Bloom. They may have a separate contract, an executive contract, and then a talent contract. I have no idea. I have no idea. But that's something I was talking about that 2 years ago. M. Mills with the $20, no message, just showing some love. M. Mills, thank you very much. Heard from you quite a bit over the past week. Thank you. Amiibo Juice, AEW are the AEW, oh, are the A's. I wasn't sure what that said. Are the A's or the Mets of pro wrestling? Just sell. Philip Moreland. I thought things might be different under Steve Cohen, and so far they haven't been, unfortunately. Philip says, I want AEW to succeed. I really do, but tonight was sad. Tony Khan's infatuation with CM Punk is overshadowing his own talent. It's overshadowing his own pay-per-view. Matt Omen, how much of this donation goes to you and how much goes to YouTube? Love your work, Solo. The YouTube split is, unless it's changed, it's usually 70-30 in favor of the content creator percent. 70%, I think, content creator, 30% of it goes to YouTube. So that is the split. Matt, thank you, though, for that super chat. Frankie Yankee, Tony Khan doesn't really know how to run his business. He's a fanboy who runs a wrestling company. Look who his EVPs are. Alex says, Brother Solo, do you see Cody having an EVP-like position in WWE after his in-ring retirement? If he wants it, it's his. I think he'd be really good in that position too, but I don't know what his aspirations are. He's talked about wanting to run for office or Senate. I could see him being a politician one day. But if he wants to stick around in wrestling, absolutely. Yeah, I think I could definitely see him in a position like that. RB065, may I offer roast beef sandwiches and curly fries in these troubled times? If you take away that segment, I think Dynamite was solid. I know it doesn't mean much, but thank you for keeping me going. RB, thank you, man. Now you got me hungry. Now I'm hungry. Thank you for the 10 spot. I appreciate that. Plus Ultra Adrian, if you look up the word petty in the dictionary, you will see a picture of Tony Khan next to it. That segment was extremely stupid. By the way, I'm being told, because I don't have it in front of me, that we have over 1,400 likes so far on this video. I haven't even gotten through all the messages yet. Can we do 2,000? Or is that a little Is that a little ambitious? Oh, look who it is. It's CM Punk choking out Jack Perry. Who needed the footage? You got it right there. There it is. But yeah, if we're worth 1,400, let's shoot for 1,500 and then see how far we can go. Hit that like button. Prince Vegeta says, Nick Khan is the best Khan in wrestling. Philip, $5. We appreciate you, Solomonster. You are the hardest working man in podcasting. Keep up the great work and have a great night. Philip, I appreciate that more than you know, especially after this week. And hey, Philly, Philly215, welcome to the channel. Cody welcomes you. DEH says, even for ratings, a ratings bump, knowing that CM Punk was the reason you got the biggest rating of the year when you signed Monet, Ospreay, and Okada is embarrassing. You're not wrong. That's why I mean, like, if they pop a big number tonight, great. Terrific. What does it really mean? What is it going to mean for next week when they fall back down to earth? NBA DeCali is releasing the security footage, AEW's finger poke of doom, Bash on the Beach, Eric Bischoff spoiling Mick Foley title win, or David Arquette winning the title for ratings moment, or Russo being champ. Boy, you named a lot of horrible moments there. You know what? It's too soon to tell. I hope not. I hope not. I hope Tony Khan realizes that he fucked up and he made a big mistake by doing that. I hope he's self-aware enough to understand that and moves on from it. It's too early to say. I don't think so necessarily, but who knows? Who knows? Hey, Lalo. Lalo says their YouTube video has edited out Punk. What do you mean? You're talking about the segment on their YouTube channel? They took Punk out? Isn't that the whole point of posting the segment in the first place? I don't know what you mean by that. EJ Slemp, if this doesn't win most disgusting promotional tactic, then I don't know what does. DEH says, Renee looking uncomfortable. She is friends with Steph. She did make a uncomfortable face when Ospreay made that crack about Triple H. Anthony Remy, I don't hate AEW for this. Glad I got to see the footage. I hate Punk and Perry more for this. Well, I blame Colt more and his silly podcast. It just blows my mind, the idea that everything that has happened, everything that happened 2 years ago, everything that happened last year, that it all revolves...
Look, everyone, it's Samoa Bro.
That it all revolves around Colt Cabana. Unbelievable. I don't even remember the last time I saw his face on my television. It's unreal. What a waste. What a fucking gigantic waste. Rizzo, when I was going through my divorce, I posted some pretty petty crap on Facebook, so I get being petty, but I'm also not a billionaire owner of a wrestling company. You have to turn the other cheek sometimes, Tony Khan. EJ Slemp, buy or sell on the better interviewer, Michael Landsberg or Ariel Helwani? I'm going to go Ariel for one reason. And Michael Landsberg, he did good interviews. I enjoyed watching those old On the Record TSN interviews that he did. You can find a lot of them still up on YouTube. He constantly interrupted people. And that was the one thing that it's like Howard Stern. Howard Stern is one of the great interviewers of our time. He really is. Except for the fact that he constantly talks over people. It's the one thing I can't stand when it comes to interviews. Like, when I do interviews, you know, and not even just the one I did with Mark Henry the other day or any of the interviews I've ever done, I try to go out of my way to not talk over. Like, I consciously try not to do that because it drives me nuts. And sometimes somebody will be about to say something interesting and then they'll be interrupted and then they'll be distracted and they won't come back to it. And that drives me even more nuts. Ariel is very good at not interrupting people. Michael Landsberg was awful at it. So for that reason alone, I will go with Ariel Helwani. This journey called life. Hey, Tony Khan, look at you now. Look at you now. Will Chisholm says, I want to see Andrade slapping Sammy Guevara now. Or what was the other one? Eddie Kingston and Sammy Guevara? That was the other one? We have got Devin from New Jersey, 2000. My associate says that only marks want to focus on the wrestling when they have a choice in what segments to watch or ignore. What are your thoughts? I think it's a stupid comment that your associate makes, your associate, because we are all marks. The wrestlers are the biggest marks of all. But everybody is a mark. Everybody that listens to wrestling podcasts or watches wrestling YouTube streams or watches a wrestling show or buys a wrestling t-shirt, everybody is a mark. It's a stupid derogatory term to begin with because it applies to basically everyone. So it's a stupid argument to make. Marios says, good grief, give me liberty, give me cancer. I would hope not. Chris Faplander, look at this, Chris is back. AEW armed with demos and career suicide lore. Chris Mike Sell, Solo, if you can, would you please give your thoughts on why Linda has not divorced Vince? I'm sure Stephanie and Shane can look out for her. I have no idea what goes on in that freaky marriage. I don't even want to know. I don't really care. It always struck me as a marriage of convenience. He's been cheating on this woman for fucking 30 years. Why does any woman stay with a man who openly cheats on them? I don't know. You'd have to ask them. I think it's a marriage of convenience. Yeah, that's it. Beyond that, I don't really care, and it's none of my business. El Prezcat says, if only we had this in WWF 97 with HBK and Brett. We didn't need it. It played out on TV. We already saw everything we needed to see. Except the hair pulling. Arabian Night, buy or sell on who more likely is to return to WWE, Adam Cole or Jon Moxley? I would say Adam Cole. I think Mox is very happy where he is. You know, and his wife works there and he's got the freedom to work indies, which he loves doing. So I, of the two, would say Cole over Mox. Detective Tyler, any chance we hear the Who Chose You? Give me his name, punk line in the podcast intro eventually. It's too funny for it not to be in. I don't know. It's kind of long. We'll see. It's a possibility. Hey, LJ, thank you for the sub. Isaias Carlos says AEW won't be the same after tonight to him. Dixie Normus, Mina, oh, come on. Mira Sheridan, it's on my face. So we have a Mira, it's Mina. I keep saying Mira. I don't know why it looked like Mira to me. Nier says, one thing is certain, Cody knew what he was doing. Yes, he did. Cody knew. Rahul, how much would this hurt or elevate Jack Perry, do you think? I think Jack Perry is damaged goods coming out of this. I really do. I think it hurts more than it helps. You could say, oh, it puts heat on him, and you could try to get heat on him as the man who got CM Punk fired, basically, even though that's, again, I wouldn't even bring any of this up at all anymore. I just think it does more damage to him than anything else. This will always be associated with him now, and it's going to follow him for the rest of his career that he was associated with this. And to me, he's just damaged goods. Boots says, I was more annoyed with the aggressive zooms. Merlot Williams, much love and respect for the responses. My intent was to point out the carniness of wrestling and demonstrate that this stuff has been around forever. And it has been. And there's been far worse things that have happened, unfortunately. Behind the scenes with people who dole out their own form of punishment to other people. It was the Wild West in wrestling for a very long time. My point is, it's not the Wild West anymore. And if you want to run a real business and you want to be looked at as a real business, then you got to run a real business. And the way you do that is by punishing people who put their hands on their coworkers when they're not supposed to. And if there are other people out there who still don't understand that and can't see past it, then there's no point in arguing with these people, because I'm never going to be able to get through to them. And I think it says more about them than anything else. David says, Tony Khan, please release the Jericho MVP cruise fight next. Oz and Glorious, missed my first Dynamite since 2021. Still wanted to say thank you for being the only wrestling content creator reviewer that has not become an overly biased, shameless, hyperbolic Triple H bootlicker for money. Well, thank you. That was a mouthful. But thank you. I appreciate that. Chris Mike Sell, buy or sell on who would you want to finish their first title run without getting hurt? Batista 05 in his run or Seth Rollins in 2015? I don't know. I mean, I don't remember when Batista got hurt who he was feuding with or was about to feud with. Rollins in 2015. I would probably say Rollins in 2015. I mean, that was tough, him getting hurt like that and being gone for so long. I might go with, I mean, I don't want anybody to get hurt, but I might go Rollins on that. Ken Masters Hadouken says, what's worse, Tony Schiavone listening to Bischoff and airing on TV the results of Mick Foley's title win, or tonight's airing of Brawl In? I think tonight's airing of Brawl In was more embarrassing, to be honest with you. I think what Bischoff did was just stupid, and it chased viewers off, and he paid the price for it. But Bischoff had been doing that for a while. I mean, he had been spoiling the shows, just generally being a dick. I don't know that it embarrassed the company. I mean, I guess they were embarrassed by the fact they chased off hundreds of thousands of viewers. I wonder how many viewers may have been chased off by this whole thing, even tonight. But I think just the airing of the video tonight was completely embarrassing. Even more so than that was. Boney says, this reminded me of Vince being petty and advertising the Donald Trump Rosie O'Donnell segment. In your opinion, which was worse? I don't know. I mean, they're all fucking terrible. That was a terrible fucking segment. This was a terrible fucking segment. They're all terrible. It's just bad TV. It's just bad TV. No matter which way you slice it. Bid Moon, Tony Khan couldn't stand watching Happy Punk during Mania Weekend. Lady Fire Panda, thank you for the 20. Bid Moon, thank you for the $4.99. Fire Panda says, if Cody becomes President of the United States, does he keep his wrestling entrance for any speech he gives? And does the pyro get even bigger? Forget that. You know, when he comes out before every speech, everybody has to do the whoa. All the news media, they have to do the whoa. Everybody in the audience has to do the whoa. You got to keep the whoa. Goldberg versus Tavish with the $9.99, giving me horrible flashbacks here. And we are at 1,500 likes, by the way, so thank you very much. Winston, I did mention you at the very beginning, like way earlier, so you may have missed it. But thank you, brother. Oz and Glorious says, noteworthy tweet. If an abhorrent sex trafficking lawsuit didn't kill a certain company, a one-minute video of some dude assaulting his coworker backstage is not going to kill another company. Yeah, I don't know if anybody was saying that it's going to kill them, but it's, you know, it's just a horrible look for them, and it could begin. Look, if they don't figure out why the numbers are going down, they're going to have a real problem. And that really is the bigger issue more than anything else. Airing one video doesn't kill them. What it does, though, is distract from what they should be doing. And I think that's the bigger point here, which is focusing on their product and trying to bring people in instead of chasing them away. I don't see how this brings anybody in. You know, maybe for one night it does. Bliss fan, what'd he say? He said Sean Spears responded. What did Sean Spears say? Randall the Sandal. Thank you for being amazing. Love you, Solomonster. Thank you, Randall. Thank you very much. There he is. There's Cody. Ed K, thank you for the sub. Barry says, they really did remove Punk when they posted it to YouTube. It's just the Bucks talking and FTR coming out. Well, that's fucking lame. Why even post it in the first place? I mean, the whole reason that the whole reason that the segment continued with FTR coming out was to respond to the footage that they aired. So did they chop up the FTR promo? You almost have to. Like, without the footage, there's no point in even posting the segment. The whole thing is just, the whole thing is stupid. The whole thing is just incredibly dumb. Arabian Knight says, buy or sell, which 3-year span of WWE was worse in terms of creative and matches? 94, 95, 96, or 2018, 2019, 2020? I mean, you know, the gimmicks in 95 were horrible. But there was a lot of good, and maybe I'm just being nostalgic, but I thought there was enough good from that period for me growing up as a fan during that period. I'd still put 94, 95, 95 for a while there was bad, but 94, 96, I might still put that above 2018, 2019, 2020. There was a lot of bad stuff, especially on Raw during that period. Put it this way, you're way more likely to find me bringing up a random show or a pay-per-view or something from 94, 95, 96 on Peacock than you will a 2018, 2019, or 2020 show. I rest my case. Oz and Glorious says, bigger cheap shot, CM Punk hitting Jack Perry while he was fixing his hair, or Bobby Bacala hitting Anthony Soprano over Janice. Well, he had it coming. He was mouthing off to his sister, but that's the man's wife. He had it coming. Poor Bobby. Devin says, I'll get my peers to watch your stream. Please do. It sounds like you have some associates who need to start watching, so I can try to educate. Like you. They should be as smart as you are, the YouTube. Unregistered Hypercam says, the American Nightmare for President. Weird. That would be weird. Yeah, usually you try to be a little more uplifting, I guess, with the campaigns, but the American Nightmare, he might have to change that. Kentucky Dried Chicken. You're right, Solomonster. AEW does tell stories. They kept throwing fickle pickle juice in my damn eyes. Some storylines are vanilla manila. And Detective Tyler with the $9.99, you and I share the same love for Halloween. What about Michael Myers? What about him captivated you? For me, it's the silence and the subtlety of everything he did. Halloween Ends was a joke and nearly ruined him. For me, it's the mask, because it's so expressionless. So he walks around with this mask on, and there's no expression on his face. And it just creeps me out. You know, the original mask, it just creeps me out when I would look at it. And that, more than anything, is what it was. And then just the sense of dread. I thought the tension, he did a good job of building it up in that those early movies. But yeah, I was a Friday the 13th guy, and then I didn't see the first Halloween for many years, and then I did, and I fell in love with it. You know, I was late to the Halloween game. NBA DeCali, is Vince Russo now the second worst booker ever, bro? No, I'd say he still has the trophy. Nick Grasso. Grayson Waller had a funny response saying he was showing footage, or he has footage of him in theory attacking the SmackDown locker room, and Dijak chimed in and said he saw everything, there was glass everywhere. I did see that. And Oz and Gloria says, AEW's marketing efforts are non-existent compared to the Fed. When the Fed comes to that Salt Lake City, I see commercials every day on TV for weeks, plus billboards are up. Yeah, I mean, that's one of the knocks on AEW, or at least it was. I don't know if they're hopefully making inroads and taking steps to remedy that, but they've got to do a better job on marketing. You know, people need to know when they're coming to town. You know, it's hard sometimes if people don't know that you're coming to town to buy tickets and go to the show. So that's one of the things that was kind of an Achilles heel for them. They have to work on that. Hopefully they're taking steps to do that with some of their recent hires. I would hope. A Shutterbug is celebrating 8 months as a channel member. After airing that video, Toni and company made Punk a martyr, even though he is just as guilty. That's another piece of the fallout from tonight. I think you're right. I think they did make him a martyr. Dr. Bropio, the only thing worse than that brawl-in footage would be footage of Charles Mason kidnapping the commissioner somehow and getting away with it. Well, there was footage of my kidnapping, and I don't want to talk about that because it was a traumatic experience for me. I don't want to get into that again. It's not fun having a plastic bag placed over your face while your mouth is taped shut. I'm dragged into a dark room somewhere. Which, that really did happen, by the way. Hey, Dre Johnson, thank you for the sub. All right, well, that gets through the message portion of tonight's show. And you guys were incredible with all the support. I hope I made sense. You know, I like to think that I am making sense, even if you don't agree with everything that I say. But it's just sad, you know, more than anything else, that we sit here and we talk about this. It's not the way it used to be with these AEW shows. And it was a mistake, but it was one that was easily avoidable. And this was a conscious decision that Tony Khan made. It was the wrong decision. And I hope for his sake he didn't chase off more people than he brought in. But I don't see how what he aired tonight is going to bring in a single new fan to this company. And I would like to think that if you're someone in his position, when you sit down and you book out these shows and you're trying to make a decision about what you're going to put on your television show, that the decisions you make are based in how can we keep people tuned in and how can we bring new people into the show. And if there's something that you're about to go ahead and do, and you say to yourself, I don't see how this is going to bring any new people, and you know what? I won't do that. You need somebody who can say that and who can say, you know what? This is a bad decision to make. It doesn't really benefit us in any meaningful way, so let's not do that. Evidently, Tony Khan doesn't think that way. Anyway, the goal tonight was a modest 450 likes, and boy, did you guys blow that out of the water. And we're going to get to Be the Booker in just a moment, but first, Christian with a 499 says, this whole thing is disheartening. I wanted AEW to truly succeed, but for now, it just feels like a slow, dying promotion, and that is a shame. Swerve Strickland, on the verge of becoming the first black AEW world champion in 10 days, most likely. Completely overshadowed by nonsense. Pretty fucking sad. Let's be the booker.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is now time to be the booker.
Time to be the booker. You guys killed it on the likes. I thank you for that very much. It helps out the video a great deal. And as we usually do, we are going to kick things off here with Tag Team Be the Booker. And see what kind of matches we can randomly book. Just a fun thing we do here at the end of these streams. I put this whole thing together a while ago. We do a tag match, a women's match, and a men's match. So let's go ahead and do that now. We have The Undertaker and The Big Show. The Unholy Alliance. That's right, they were tag team champions there for a while. That was back in 99. Undertaker and Big Show. Undertaker and Big Show going to be stepping into the ring to take on the Hart Foundation. I'd call that a marquee match, wouldn't you? Bret Hart and Jim the Anvil Neidhart against The Undertaker and The Big Show. Hell yeah. Hell yeah. Hey, Coco and Cinnamon, thank you. Yeah, that's exactly what it was. All for a rating. All right, women's Be the Booker. We get Rhea Ripley to start us off. Rhea Ripley, I realize here, has had many different looks in her career. She started out as a blonde, then she went with the black hair. She's had different hairstyles, and she's always transforming her look. And she always looks fantastic. All right, Rhea Ripley. Gonna go one-on-one with who? Who is she gonna wrestle? It's gonna be Rhea Ripley and Lita. How are we feeling about that? Rhea Ripley and Lita. One-on-one. All right, men's be the booker. Let's wrap this up. Wrap this up. Men's be the booker. We kick things off with, how about the timing of this? Danhausen. We have Danhausen in Be the Booker on a night where I'm being told, I haven't seen it myself, but people telling me Danhausen was defending Punk and posted all kinds of stuff on social media. He's in a mood, it looks like. We land on Danhausen. Now we just got to land on CM Punk. Wouldn't that be something? If he ended up facing CM Punk in Be the Booker. Let's see. Danhausen, one-on-one. With Razor Ramon. Danhausen and Razor Ramon is the match I never knew I needed. But we got a clean sweep. All bells tonight. I give it the bell because I would just love to see Scott Hall's reactions when he's in there with Danhausen. It would kind of be like the first time he wrestled Goldust, I would imagine, where he's like, what the hell is this guy doing? Razor Ramon and Danhausen. That would be interesting. That would be entertaining, I think. Just for the reactions alone, that would be entertaining. Got some more super chats here coming in. And thank you for everybody who has dropped a dono tonight. TK Banks, thank you for the five. The YouTube video of Matt and Nick talking of the backstage brawl already has over 2,500 dislikes to 700 likes. The dislikes have now been hidden. Should have thought about that before they posted it. Kentucky Dry Chicken says, Winona Ryder, Joan Jett, and Sandra Bullock were smoking hot in the 90s. Yeah, I was a Sandra Bullock guy myself. First time I ever saw her, she did a movie called The Net. You should look it up. It's a good movie. Haley Lucas. The only thing pathetic is Punk stands condoning literal assault on someone. Shame on all of you. BW Rojas, or Roses, says AEW is True TV Discovery bound due to stuff like this. Well, he better hope not. Tony Khan better hope not. But if that's the case, he'll have nobody to blame but himself. Super cool. Punk footage as bad as the cocaine spot on the NWA. If it cost them a television deal, it would be. Imagine that. I don't think it's going to cost them a TV deal like it did to Mr. Corgan over there, at least for a while. Apparently now they have gotten their footing with the TV network there. But yeah, that was a whole mess for them, wasn't it? Daniel Malcolm, thank you for the gifted. Everybody, by the way, who gifted memberships to other people on the channel, man, thank you. Very much appreciate that. JM, again, man, I can't thank you enough for the support. Thank you and everybody else. Oz and Gloria says, Winona Ryder for life. That's right. I think I first saw her in Beetlejuice. That probably would have been the first movie I saw her in. You're taking me back, man. You're taking me back with all these references here. Although I will say my big crush, I had a few of them, actually, in the 90s. I can't say I just had one. I was going to say Jennifer Love Hewitt, but Jennifer Love Hewitt was one, but Kelly Kapowski, Saved by the Bell, come on. Come on. I'm sure I wasn't the only one. All right. It's about time I get on out of here. I really was hoping that this was not going to be what I thought it was, but it was. And now we see, I guess, what happens when the numbers come in tomorrow. And then we see what happens next week when they have to get back to reality and they don't have CM Punk to rely on anymore to pop a number. And by then, they'll be less than a week away from Dynasty. So I certainly hope they have something good planned for next week's show. I'm going to be with you on Friday night. It's going to be another big stream because it is the SmackDown coming out of WrestleMania. So I would expect that we would have Roman Reigns on the show. I don't know if The Rock is going to make one more appearance before he goes away. If we get Rock and Roman in a segment together, if there's some big bloodline development, we'll find out. And I hope you guys will come on back and join me for that on Friday night. For what has been, really going back to last Wednesday, has been one of the biggest weeks ever on this channel. So hopefully I will see you then. Until then, be well, stay safe. Thank you for the love. Thank you for hanging out with me. Hit that like button on the way out. And I will see you back here for a big SmackDown stream Friday night back here on YouTube. Take care, guys.